My name is Dr. Bill Haig, and we're making this life story because it has some amazing, unusual things that have occurred on our 43-year ministry. My wife and I have been missionaries for 43 years. We've gone from the Arctic Circle in Fort Yukon to the volcanoes in Guatemala to Montserrat, the island of Montserrat that actually is a volcano that exploded and destroyed the island. Everybody had to move off the island, belongs to England. And then we went to Russia, all over Central America, Cuba. We've been working in Cuba, Russia, and Red China. And we've had some very, very unusual things that have happened. We were in Puerto Rico, which is a center for UFO activity, part of the Bermuda Triangle. And then we were in the Philippines, where the Muslims blew up a couple buses and a mall when we were just as we were landing the airplane in Manila. And then we were in Guatemala. A civil war took place, and the communists were trying to overthrow the government. And we're going to go over all those areas. We're going to divide this into four main areas. And the first area is in Central America. But let me just give a little background about my life personally. My parents were not Christians. I did not have the benefit of growing up in a Christian home. We had a very happy childhood up till about 8 years old. My dad and mother were doing well. My dad had two businesses going. He worked as a welder in a company, and then he had a painting business out of the business. But then my parents started getting in a fuss, ended up getting a divorce. And at the age of 8 years old, I ended up going to jail because of this divorce. And what had happened was my parents were fighting. The police had actually been called to our house several times. They'd gotten in actually physical fights and blood running down the face and the police coming. And it was just a horrible, horrible thing. And then my parents filed for divorce, and my dad filed an injunction against my mother that she could not have temporary custody. And then my mother filed an injunction against my dad that he could not have temporary custody. And so what are you going to do? Well, they put my sister, who was 12 years old, in the orphanage, in the Franklin County Orphanage in Columbus, Ohio, because she was a girl and she was 12 years old. And they put my brother, who was 5, they put him in the orphanage. There were two places in the orphanage. But there wasn't any enough room in the orphanage for me. I was 8 years old, so what did they do? Said, well, you can't go with mom, you can't go with dad, so I know you can't go with the orphanage because it's full, so I know what we'll have to do. We'll put little Billy, we'll put him in the juvenile detention center. And so at the age of 8 years old, I went to jail because of my parents' divorce. And let me just say this, I would really encourage you, don't get a divorce. You can't afford it. It causes too many problems. It'll destroy your children. And you need to work things out. And I just dealt with a couple this last week. It's just they got two beautiful little girls and about to get a divorce. But you try to avoid that. So at the age of 8 years old, I went to jail. And it's supposed to be just a temporary thing, but I ended up being in jail for a year. And got beat up in jail, and they would steal the guard in the jail had my parents had given me some presents and stuff, my mother when she come to visit, and so the guard actually would steal from the kids in the juvenile detention center. And then one guard there slapped me around, beat me up, and I swore I would kill that guy when I got out of there. Big old guy beating up a little kid like that. And it is very, very fortunate that I got saved at the age of 19. Because if I hadn't got saved at the age of 19, I would have tracked him down and killed him with my bare hands. And I'm glad that I got saved. Amen. I'd be in jail right now. Thank God. You know, the Lord can get rid of that bitterness over bad things that happen in your childhood. And so, let me say this. Some people say, oh, man, Brother Haig, that's terrible. You went to jail when you were 8 years old, got beat up by the guard, and they're stealing your stuff and stealing the presents your parents brought for you. And I said, yeah, but you know, one thing I've noticed, and I mean this sincerely, every one of the worst things that have happened in my life, as I look back over the last 65 years, every one of those things worked out for good. I say, well, how can going to jail work out for good as a little, you're a little kid going to jail. How's that going to work out for good? And I said, I'll tell you how it worked out for good. When we were getting ready to go to Cuba the first time, I had several very close friends saying, Brother Haig, don't go to Cuba because Castro will put you in jail. And I said, you know what? Listen, when I was 8 years old, I went to jail when I was 8 years old, and I ain't worried about Castro's jail. Amen. And so another thing, I had cancer when I, just 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with advanced prostate cancer. And the doctor said there was nothing he could do, that I was going to basically, I probably would die. He said, well, there's nothing I can do. Radiation might help, but you're in God's hands now. But I look back over that, and that was a very trying experience, but we were able to get through it. I've been cancer-free for 10 years. Amen? Cancer-free for 10 years. Not only that, I've been able to help over 300 men and six different preachers. I was able to get them into the cancer clinic, and they've been cured of cancer. So suppose the Lord came down to you and said, look, there are 300 men down here going to die, and there's six preachers, pastors of churches over here. They're going to die. But I want you, Bill, I want you to help them. Would you help me help them? I say, yeah, Lord, I'll help you. What do you want me to do? I want you to get cancer. Whoa! Well, you want me to, yeah, I want you to go through the process so you can help these pastors. And so I look back over that and I said, thank God for cancer, amen. They're able to save the life of six pastors and about 300 different men. And praise the Lord for that. I remember when I was 24 years old, 23 years old, I was engaged to this girl and she broke the engagement. And it was just all very, very unfair. What happened was I was engaged to this girl up in Columbus, Ohio, and she went to visit her grandmother in New York. And so right at the following week, they were having a Billy Graham crusade. Well, the church that I was attending at that time was cooperating in the Billy Graham crusade, and I was singing in the Billy Graham choir. You know, that's and my fiance, her cousin said, look, I'm singing in the Billy Graham choir too, and I don't have any transportation. Would you come by and pick me up? Now, her cousin was big and fat and ugly. No reflection on the fat people. But so, you know, I thought, okay, I can go pick up this big, fat, ugly girl and take her down there to the Billy Graham crusade. And then because she, you know, had some physical problems and she had some personal problems, when we would come back from the Billy Graham crusade, she would ask me to pray about her problems, pray about her parents and pray about school and pray with her about this. And so we would sit out in front of their house there, which was right next door to where my fiance lived, and I'd pray with her about it, and then she'd get out. Well, when my fiance came back, she said, one of the nosy neighbors there said, yeah, your boyfriend was picking your cousin up, and then they're sitting out here in front of her house necking every night when they came back from the Billy Graham crusade. First of all, that's an insult to injury, okay? This girl, I mean, I'm telling you, anyway, so she broke the engagement. I mean, it's terrible. And gave me back the engagement ring and all this kind of stuff. And I actually thought about committing suicide. I can sympathize people who commit suicide. And I thought, you know what? If I commit suicide, she'll just go off and marry somebody else and be happy ever after. I said, I'm not going to commit suicide. And so then we went on. And while I was in high school, I played in a rock and roll band. I had a $690 set of drums. And we had two electric guitars and electric bass, and we'd go out and play in these dances for the moose and the elk and different social events. And one thing that's very interesting about playing in a rock and roll band is you can go out and enjoy the pleasure of seeing you out there. You're one of the big stars and everything, get a lot of attention. But when you have to sit on your front porch and you don't have the peace of God, it isn't worth it. I like during the Gulf War, they had the programs coming on television to say, I am an American. They have different ethnic groups. Well, I started off one sermon saying this, I am an American, amen? My grandfather on my mother's side was wounded in World War I and died from the wounds that he got in World War I. I am an American. My father was wounded in World War II. He was a gunner's mate on a destroyer in World War II, had a big gash across, a big scar across his arm here, where he'd been hit by shrapnel. And it's a miracle they hadn't been, they weren't killed. And my father was wounded in World War II. I am an American. My great-grandfather on my mother's side was a Cherokee Indian. And if we'll have the cameraman switch over there to picture number 12. You can picture over there, down there on the bottom, picture number 12. You'll see me dressed up there in my Indian outfit. And we have a horse there named Daisy. I joined the Cherokee Nation of Ohio. Okay, we have a whole video that goes 5 hours on the American Indians and the Bible. And it's real interesting what the Bible has to say about the American Indians. So I am an American. I'm a member of the Cherokee Indian Nation. I played in a rock and roll band. My grandfather was wounded in World War I, and my father was wounded in World War II. I am an American. Amen. So I can claim I'm an American, especially going back to the Cherokee Indian stuff. I joined the Cherokee Indian Nation because we had an opportunity. I was preaching at a mission conference, and this one missionary said, "Brother Haig, would you come up to Gallup, New Mexico?" This is another one of those great stories, Dale. "Would you come out and preach to the Navajo Indians in Gallup, New Mexico?" Amen. Great idea. So we took our youth group. We went out to the Grand Canyon. We went to Gallup, New Mexico, and we're driving down Interstate 40. And I called him on the cell phone. I said, "Okay, Brother Bernie, now where do we get off?" He said, "Well, when you come down Interstate 40, when you get to Route 666, that's where you turn off." I said, "What?" He said, "You're going down Interstate 40, and when you get to Route 666, that's where you turn off." I said, "Brother, your church ain't on Route 666, is it?" He said, No. "You go down there, we're over there on 3rd Avenue or 2nd or 3rd Avenue or something." I thought, my goodness, man. So we got off of Route 666, you know, and they have a Route 666 out there in New Mexico. And so when you say that, you know, and you say, "Oh, you Christians, you are so superstitious." Yeah, we're superstitious. Let me tell you something, brother. They got a town out in Death Valley called Hell. The official name of the valley is Hell, H-E-L-L. You're driving down the road, it says, "Welcome to the city of Hell." No, thank you. I'll take the bypass. I ain't going there. Amen. The reason they call it Hell, it is so hot that people put their underwear in the freezer at night, and then they put it on in the morning because they didn't have any air conditioning. It was so hot, if you have rubber shoes, they will melt. And they had a picture of a guy cracking an egg on a rock in his backyard and frying the egg on a rock. That's pretty hot, okay. So we're driving. We go out there to Gallup, New Mexico to preach to the Navajo Indians. Went out, preached in the Hogan. But we had a big youth rally. Had 400 teenagers come in and gave an invitation. We had, I think, 30 or 40 saved, which was tremendous among the Indians. But after the big youth rally with the 400 teenagers, I'd taken everything out of my van. Dale, can you imagine me taking everything out of my van, taking all my stuff out of my van? And we used my van and the other Indian van to go out to the Navajo Indian Reservation and and bring the teenagers in for this big youth rally, pizza party thing. And so, no problem. They went out, brought them back. On the way to return them, the native Indian, his van, driving down Route 666 on the way to the Navajo Indian Reservation, the wires under the dash short-circuited, caught fire, and the entire van burnt up on Route 666. What a coincidence, huh? Yeah. You know, I just love something I like to stay away from him. Stay away from the devil. Stay away from 666. Stay away from certain things. And so I am an American. I became a member of the Cherokee Indian Nation. We went up to the Six Nation Indian Reservation in Canada. Had a great time up there preaching with Brother Bernie when he moved up there. Had a lot of people saved. I am an American. After going through high school, I was working in the shoe department in Columbus, Ohio, planning on being a millionaire. And I'm glad I finally made it. Everybody wants to be a millionaire. They have a thing there saying, "Who wants to be a millionaire?" You know, and everybody said, "I want to be a millionaire. I want to be a millionaire." You know, I asked one guy, I said, "Why? Why do you want to be a millionaire?" He said, "Well, because it'll make you happy, right?" Not necessarily. Well, I'm glad I finally made it. I got my $5 million right here. This is 5 million pesos from Bolivia. And so I was planning on being a millionaire. And I said, well, you need to go to college. So I started saving up money to go to college. And while I was in this, working at this shoe factory in Columbus, Ohio, I started reading the Bible. And people would ask me, they'd say, man, now this was before I was singing in the Billy Graham Crusade. And so I was working there in that shoe factory in Columbus, Ohio, trying to save $1 million. And I started reading the Bible. I said, all right, if somebody wants to be happy, then how are you going to be happy without knowing the one to whom it all belongs? The ground belongs to God, the air, the food, everything belongs to him. And so I said, well, I know what I'll do. I'll read the Bible. And then when somebody says thus and so, I don't know if it's thus and so or not. And so I started reading the Bible as a lost person. And I go all the way through the Old Testament. People would ask me, said, man, you're always sitting around reading the Bible every day at lunch, every day in the afternoon in the break. I'd read the Bible. And they thought I was a great Christian, and I wasn't even saved. And so after 1 year of reading all the way through the Bible as a lost person, I realized that I was going to go to the lake of fire for all eternity. And I said, man, I'm in trouble. I'd read through there, and I'd read about the Jewish people. They'd have one good king, then they'd have five bad ones. Then they'd have one good king, then they'd have five bad ones. And I looked at it, I said, man, those Jewish people, they just keep making a mess. And I said, all right, you know what? I want to be happy. And you can't be happy without knowing the one to whom it all belongs. And so at the age of 19, I realized that I needed to accept Christ, my personal Savior. I would go to three churches every Sunday. I'd go to the early service of one church and go to the second service, the 9 o'clock service, and then the 10 o'clock service, and then I'd go to an evening service, and I'd go to all these different churches. But reading the Bible, I realized that I was lost, and at the age of 19, I accepted Christ as my personal Savior. That's the greatest decision I've ever made. If I hadn't done that, I believe sincerely I would have been killed. I would have died of cancer or would have died of something else if I hadn't accepted Christ. I never would have made it to 65. My father died at age, I think, about 64 of prostate cancer. And I found out about the clinic that actually has extended my life now another 10 years by being in a Baptist church. I didn't find out that from the urologist. I talked to about five different urologists in Pensacola, Florida. They never would have given me the right information. And so after I accepted Christ my personal Savior, I said, I need to learn, I need to go, and God spoke to me about becoming a missionary. And one of the things is, I'm not a gregarious person. I'm not the person like to go out and have friends. I could never be a politician or anything. And so getting up and speaking in front of people, I could never do that. When I was in high school, I would take an F before I would get up and give a two-minute book report. I'd read the book and write out the report, but I'm not getting up in front of any group. Matter of fact, before I got saved, the devil said to me, said, you better not get saved, because you do, God might call you to preach. And I said, no, God's never called me to preach. I could never get up in front of anybody and say anything, man. I can't even give a two-minute book report. God knows I could never preach. And so I got saved because I knew I was never going to have to. God would never call me to preach. Well, after I got saved, about a year later, the Lord spoke to me about becoming a missionary and going to all over the world. And so at the age of 19, I accepted Christ. At the age of 20, I got called to preach. I was up in Lorain, Ohio, and the pastor there, the church I got baptized in, got baptized in the Baptist church there. He said, he was a graduate of Bob Jones University. He said, okay, look, Bill, he said, I'm going to take you down there, and we're going to get you registered in school. And so I got registered in school and went to Bob Jones University for 3 years, where I met my wife. The interesting thing about that, going to Bob Jones University, is I was a very quiet, reserved kind of person who was going to have to learn how to preach and go out and be a missionary. And one thing that was amazing is I got saved. I became a Christian reading the Bible. Okay, read all the way through as a lost person. I didn't know anything, but I knew this book was true. And when I say the Bible, I mean the King James Bible. And so when I got there to that school, there were some teachers there that didn't believe that. They thought the Bible had errors in it, mistakes, and I kept having conflicts with teachers and administrators, not because I did anything wrong, but because they didn't like what the Bible said sometimes. Now, it's a fundamental school, and they believe in soul winning, but let me tell you something. When they have a choice between following what the Bible says and doing what they want to do in the rules of their college, they're going to do what they do, and they really don't care what the Bible says. And I had a run-in with Dr. Bob Jones Sr. I mean, not senior, he was getting very old then. I got a run-in with Dr. Bob Jones Jr. I had a run-in with Dr. Bob Jones III, who was the president of the college. I sat in his office for about an hour and a half discussing the Bible one time, and I just made up my mind. I wasn't bending. He could throw me out or whatever. The Bible's right. He's wrong. I don't care, man. Throw me out. They didn't expel me. And so finally, after 3 years, I figured I better leave before I had to run in with the dean of men and with a thing over the Bible. And I'm going, this is just ridiculous. So finally, after 3 years, they called me and said, okay, now next year you're going to graduate. Said, what are you going to take? And I said, well, I won't be here next year. I'm not coming back. Said, what? I said, no, I'm going down to Pensacola, Florida, Bible college down there, where I'm going to take Hebrew and I'm going to take church history. Yeah, you couldn't take Hebrew in the undergraduate program at Bob Jones. And I did not care about the degree. I wasn't interested in any diploma. I just wanted to get the information, the facts and stuff, the education I needed to do what I want to do. And so I said, I'm leaving. You can take your degree and you can have it. I don't care about your stupid degree. Well, so I did that, went down to Pensacola, studied Hebrew, studied church history, went on to the mission field. And when I came back from the mission field, we were in a mission conference out in Kansas City, Kansas, and there was a big discussion about whether the Bible had errors in it or not. And I'll never forget what the pastor said. Well, you know, this guy over here that said the Bible has mistakes in it is Dr. Peterson. He has a doctor's degree. And who are you? You don't even have a BA. Now, I had done all the work, and I could have applied for a BA degree, okay, because I'd done more than the hours required, but I didn't care about the diploma. And he said, well, he has a doctor's degree. Who are you? No, I said, is that right? Is that the way it works around here? Okay, the next time, I'll go ahead and do the coursework, and I'll have a doctor's degree. So because of these conflicts with people not believing the Bible and then other people being influenced by people because of their academic credentials, I went on. I get up at 4:30 in the morning, and for the next 4 or 5 years, I did graduate work by extension. And I got 2 master's degrees. I got a Master of Arts and a Master of Divinity. And then I got 3 doctorate degrees, a PhD in education, a THD in theology, and a Doctor of Ministry degree. So I have 2 master's degrees and 3 earned doctorate degrees, not honorary doctorate degrees. And I had to write 5 books in order to get those, 5 theses in order to get that. But I was really amazed. It really amazed me at these different colleges, at what they do with regard to the Bible. Then my wife and I, after graduating from college, we went on. I met my wife at Bob Jones University. She had just graduated and was leaving, and I was a fourth-year student, so I just left. I said, "You can have it, folks. I'm not going to argue with you about the Bible or anything else. I'm out of here." And so my wife and I then started doing deputation work. We had some unusual things happen during the deputation work. I remember I was in Charleston, West Virginia. And in Charleston, West Virginia, I was calling this Pastor Sizemore. I shared this with the bus people over here about the importance of being attuned to people and things going on around you, because God is working in your life. And sometimes we miss opportunities because we're not paying attention. And so I was in Charleston, West Virginia, getting ready to trying to call this pastor. His name was Pastor Sizemore. So I dialed the number. I said, is this Pastor Sizemore? And this guy said, no, this is Mr. Brown. You have the wrong number. I said, well, now, excuse me. Let me make sure I'm getting the right number. Now, the number I have written down here, and I had the number written down. He said, no, that's not my number. You must have dialed it wrong or something. So I said, okay, sir, I'll be very careful and dial the number, because I know this is the right number. I just talked to him yesterday, okay? So I said, let me try one more time. So I called up. I said, is this Pastor Sizemore? He said, no, this is Mr. Brown. I said, well, Mr. Brown, I'm sorry. I know I did not dial the wrong number, okay? This is the number I dialed. It's not your number. There's something up there crossing the lines. I believe an angel is up there crossing those telephone lines personally, okay? And so I said, excuse me, let me try one more time. And so I was very, very careful very meticulous to dial the right number, Pastor Sizemore, and here it was, Mr. Brown again. I said, Mr. Brown, I am so sorry. I hate to keep bothering you, but Mr. Brown, I think there must be a purpose in this. Let me ask you a question, Mr. Brown. If you died right now, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? And he said, well, no. And I went through the plan of salvation, and right there on the phone, he prayed and asked the Lord to save him. And I said, you know what, Mr. Brown? I'll bet you the next time I dial, we won't have any problems. God, thank the Lord you got saved. He said, yeah, thank the Lord for this wrong number. And so I called the fourth time in a row, dialed the same number, and I got Pastor Sizemore. Okay. I don't think that was a coincidence. I believe the Lord was doing something. You need to be aware because certain unusual things happen. When we were on deputation work, I was getting ready to put a big sign out in front of our house. We lived out on the main road going out of Pensacola, Route 29, used to be this old 29, and used to be the main road. And they had a bar right across the street from this little block house that my wife and I rented when we first got married. And so the people would come out of town, and they would have to stop right in front of our house because of the oncoming traffic, see? And so they would have to stop right in front of our house, and then when the traffic would stop, then they could turn left and go into the bar. And our house was right here on the right. And so I said to my wife, I said, you know, these people have to stop all the time in front of our house to go turn to that bar. I'm going to put a big picture up there. So I do chalk drawings and paintings and stuff. I painted this picture back here. And so I had a big chalk drawing. It's 4 feet by 8 feet on the Lake of Fire. And so I put that thing right out there facing the people that would be driving up where they could see it. You know, they could see that sign. They drive up and they'd be right there on the right. And I put big bright lights on at night. And it said, hell, what if it is true? What if it is true? And you'd see these guys, they would pull up there and they would stop at the light in the dark, you know, and they'd turn over there and see that bright light on that people burning in hell, and they'd look at that and go, whoa! You know? And so when I was painting that sign, when I was getting ready to paint this big picture there on our backyard, while I was getting it ready, there was a whole swarm of bees that got up in the trees there. I mean, this is, you know, a swarm, and what they did had the queen bee, and they're looking for a place to set up a new hive. And so these bees are there, and I jumped back. I said, good night. There's been thousands of bees there. And I said to the neighbor, I said, I'm trying to paint there under that tree in the shade, and those bees are bothering me. What do you think we should do? And he said that right down there about 2 blocks down, there's a captain, a retired captain from a ship. And he has a bunch of hives. He's raising bees for honey. And so he said, go down there. He'd probably like to come get them, put them in a hive. I said, oh, okay, good. He'll take care of my problem for me. I didn't want to spend there. So, I mean, there are thousands of them. If you tried to spray them or something, I mean, you'd just be attacked. And so I went down there. His name was, I'm trying to think what his name was. That was 40 years ago. I think it was Carver. And so I went in there, knocked on his door, and told him about my bees and all that. And he said, nah, he said, he didn't want any more bees. And he said, I found out he was related, a second cousin to my wife. And we got talking a little bit there. And then he had a big sign about like this that said, be brief. You know, he didn't want any long, drawn-out stuff, you know. And he would point to it, be brief. And so I said, well, Pastor Carver said, if you died right now, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? He said, no. And then he said, well, I'm not a bad person. And I point to his sign, be brief. Are you going to heaven or aren't you? And he said, no, I'm not. And I said, well, would you like to? He said, yes, I would. And so went through the plan of salvation, and the captain got saved because of the swarm of bees, and when I went back, the bees were gone. Amen? See, cross telephone lines, bees show up, all kinds of unusual things. You need to be attuned to what the Lord is doing. So we went on deputation, had some amazing opportunities. The hardest thing that I ever had to do was quit my job. I worked at the hospital. And with no guaranteed income, our one church took us on for $50 a month. And then $50 a month, you ain't gonna live. My wife was working as a teacher, and I worked as an orderly in the hospital. And we were making $900 a month. And just to go from $900, when that's 40 years, that'd probably be $3,000 or $4,000 now. To go from $900 a month to zero, and when you got a wife and, you know, and family, you know, that's hard to do. That's the hardest thing I ever do, just trust the Lord. But you know, these 43 years, God has never let us down. We've never missed a meal. Amen. A couple times it was close. We never missed a meal. Well, while I was in that hospital, we had some unusual things happen. While I was working in that hospital in Pensacola, Florida, sometimes I have to work in the emergency room, and every now and then I'd have to work in the psychiatric ward. Now, let me tell you something. You never, never know what's really going on in your town or in your city until you work in the hospital, until you sit in the emergency room, until you are there hours and hours at a time. For example, 2 weeks before I got married, Dale, 2 weeks before I got married, I was working in the emergency room. Now listen, and you know what happened? While I was working in that emergency room 2 weeks before I got married, they brought 5 men into the emergency room. Their Pensacola wives had shot them with a gun. I'm going, man, I don't know if I want to marry a Pensacola woman or not. You know, 5 men, their wives shot them. And you know what's the amazing thing about that? None of those instances were in the newspaper. None of them were on the radio. None of them ever hit the TV news, you know, but I found out because I was working there in the hospital. Then I'd have to work, every now and then, I'd have to work in a psychiatric ward. And while we were there, I had another student who was another orderly that was working there. He and I were students at Pensacola Bible Institute, and we had this little thing that we would do when we ride the elevator. And I'll tell you about the psychiatric ward in a minute. But in the elevator, we do this. And I'd say to him, I'd say, hey, Jim, did you ever notice the lights in the elevator? And he would say, no, Bill. What about the lights in the elevator? I said, well, look at that. The light going up is green. Do you know why it's green? And he would say, no, Bill. Why is the light green? And I'd say, well, the reason the light's green is the Bible says over here in Revelation chapter 4 that there is a rainbow around the throne of God like an emerald green. And I said, the whole world is a parable. So the light going up is green like an emerald. And I said, do you know what color the light is going down? And he'd say, no, Bill, what color is the light going down? I said, it's fiery red. I said, you know what? I'm glad when I get on the elevator for the last time, I'm going with a green light up to heaven. I ain't going down to the hell with the red light. And he said, yeah, me too. And then we wouldn't say anything. And there'd be like 4 or 5 people in the elevator. And all you'd hear would be the sound of the elevator. And those people looking around, looking at those lights, you know, going up and down. I work in a hospital. And while I was working in the hospital, every now and then we have to go to a psychiatric ward. And I remember, and I told this story several times, I mentioned it last night in church. I said, I would go off to lunch and leave the psychiatric ward, go to the lunch room, and there's some amazing things, unusual things happen in that psychiatric ward. And I go and I come back and carry my Bible, and when I walked in the psychiatric ward, the patient in the room there would call to me, and he'd go, psst, psst, and I would stop, and he said, hey. He said, you can't see the little green man in the corner over there, can you? And I'd look over there. Thank God I didn't see nothing. Amen. I don't want to see any little green men in the corner. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 16 and verse 13, I saw 3 unclean spirits like frogs. Sometimes demons are invisible. Sometimes they appear in human form. Sometimes they appear in half human, half animal form, and sometimes they appear in animal form. The devil appears as a dragon, as a serpent, and here they appear as frogs, little green men. And when they talk about UFOs, they always talk about the little green man from Mars. You know why do they always say green men from Mars? They have to follow the Bible when they don't even know what the Bible says. And so, you see, while we're in this room here, there are radio waves going through here. If you have a radio receiver, you can hear them. I don't have a demon receiver. I can't hear him. Well, we're in this room right now. There are television waves right in this room right now. If you had a TV receiver, you could see those television waves. I don't have a TV receiver. I don't have a demon receiver. I can't see him. And this guy said, I know you can't see him. He said, but I can see him. I said, I'll bet you can see him. I'll bet you can see him. While I was working in that, while I was working there in the hospital, back in the psychiatric ward, we were sitting there one day with one of the student nurses. And the student nurse, we're sitting there at a table, and your job as an orderly is to just sit there and make sure things do not get out of control and make sure nobody flies apart or anybody gets hurt. You're there kind of a police officer, you know, and trying to strong arm. Now, we didn't have much trouble, but you had to be there. And so we were sitting there one day, and the student nurse was sitting here, and this patient was sitting there, and he said this. He said, raised his hands. He said, God said unto me, come unto me, and I will make you to be killers of men. And the student nurse, young lady, she said, what did you say? He said, God said unto me, come unto me, and I will make you to be killers of men. And she said, who told you that? He said, God told me that. And then she said, God who? And he said, Wotan. Wotan was a Viking god of war. And I don't doubt that Wotan did tell him to go out and kill people, because that's what Wotan would be inclined to do. All right, so there was a lot of unusual things happened there in the hospital when I was when I was going to Bible college there in Pensacola, Florida. And one of the amazing things is, I'll never forget, there were two men there dying, and the one man was an atheist. He didn't want to hear anything about the Bible. You couldn't talk to him. And the other one was a Christian guy, a man. And it was really amazing. When you walked into that Christian man's room who was dying of cancer, there was a peace and a tranquility there that you couldn't have bought for $1 million. And that unsaved guy there, I mean, he was just agitated, hated God, hated the Bible, hated everybody in the hospital, and just agitated, angry, bitter. And I thought, boy, what a terrible, terrible way to die. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalms, says, let me die the death of the righteous. The Bible said, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. So then we went on to language school. And my wife and I was studying, doing deputation work. Took us 1 year, lived in our car, drove 50,000 miles, spoke in I don't know how many hundred churches, and good night, must have been a couple hundred churches, and spoke in a lot of churches and Christian day schools. We were able to get our support, and then we went to San Jose, Costa Rica. We went there to study Spanish for 8 hours a day. And I was never a great student in school or even in college, and I thought, boy, I'm never going to learn this language, but I'm going to go and try anyway. And let me just say this. Anybody can learn a foreign language. You say, I can't learn a foreign language. If you had to learn it, if you lived in that country, and if you had to buy food by communicating in that, you know what? You will learn it. Little children learn a foreign language without ever knowing how to read or write. You know how they do? They listen, and then they practice. They listen, and they practice. And so we went down there to San Jose, Costa Rica, and we moved into this. It's amazing. We got a chance. We lived in this little ratty apartment. But very shortly after, about a month or so, we were able to move into this apartment by this doctor. And he was going to Spain to study a specialty in medicine, and he wanted some Americans who would pay in dollars to stay in his apartment, which was right near the Language Institute. I was telling Dale right before the thing, we had some amazing things happen there while we were in this doctor's apartment. One, I finally found out what it is to have what was that term I used? I told you about my wife, and she had that, that's a word. Somebody, conniption fit. I finally had a chance to see an actual conniption fit. We rented this apartment, and it was very nicely furnished. You know, a doctor lived there. It was very close, 3-4 blocks from the Language Institute that we walked to every day. And a friend of ours, Marilyn Pitzer, lived in the apartment downstairs. She was living with the Nationals. And so we're up there, and my wife one day went to the kitchen to open the kitchen. And when she opened the cabinet in the kitchen, a rat jumped on her blouse, just like that. And I mean, brother, she had a conniption fit. She just almost jumped out of her skin when that rat landed on her blouse. And I'm sure she scared the rat more than he scared her, because he took. We never did find that little mouse, and so she had a conniption fit. And when we rented this apartment, About 2 months after we had rented it, San Jose, the Costa Rican government had established diplomatic relations with the country of Russia, which was a bad thing. And so we're in this apartment in the capital city in San Jose, Costa Rica, and the Russian embassy bought, the Russian government bought the house right next door to the house where we had our apartment. They bought that house for the Russian ambassador's residence. And one of the things that they had a man, because the Russian ambassador stayed there, they had a machine gun guard standing right there at the front door, right beside our house, was a guy standing in the street with a machine gun 24 hours a day. And so we had a friend of ours, my wife was has a very close personal friend, Betty Wells, who's a psychologist in Fort Lauderdale. And she and her husband, who was the vice president of a bank at the time, came down to visit us. So they were visiting us there in San Jose, Costa Rica. And I told her, I said, we had a three-bedroom place, and they had this bedroom in the back. I said, you know, your bedroom is right beside the Russian ambassador's garden. And you can actually, from your bedroom, look out and see the Russian ambassador. She said, is that right? I said, yeah, so it was a warm, sunny day, so she opened the window, and she was looking out there. She couldn't see very well, so she leaned way out the windows to see if she could see the Russian ambassador walking around in his garden. She was upstairs, and see if she could look down there in that garden, see if she could see the Russian ambassador. And just as she was leaned way, way out there, the Russian ambassador came around the corner walking in the garden, and he saw this crazy American woman hanging out the window looking into his garden. And so he waved. You know, they're them dumb Americans up there, you know. And scared her. She tried to get back in there, you know, kind of run away. They caused an international incident. And then the pastor there at the time, one of the missionaries that we were working with in his church, he came by to pick us up on Sunday. And so we were getting, my wife and I were getting ready, and all of a sudden we heard a machine gun go off. And I thought, what in the, sound like World War III out in the front yard, you know, out in the front street. And I came down, I said, hey, brother, what's going on out here? He said, is that guard there? See that guard in front of the Russian embassy? It was a changing of the guard, and so he took the machine gun and he handed it to the guard that was coming on, and the guy grabbed it the wrong way, and when he grabbed the trigger, and the thing went off and shot about 10 rounds all over the place, and it says, it's a miracle. God, we didn't get killed standing here. I mean, it's like 10, 15 feet away from this guy with a machine gun going off in his hand. And then the last day in San Jose, Costa Rica, the last day, we just spent 1 year studying Spanish, and so we were getting ready to fly out, fly back to Pensacola, pack up our stuff, and move to Honduras. And the last day, the last night, we went to bed, had our bags all packed, getting ready to move out. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, I heard this sound, and it was a sound like something metal falling off things like this. I thought, wow, got up, turned on the lights, didn't see anything. I thought, what was that? What was that sound? Sounded like something metal hitting the ground, you know? And so I went back to bed, got up about 7 o'clock. And when we got up early in the morning, about 7 o'clock, our flight, I think, was about 10. When I got up, I noticed that there were splinters and pieces of wood on the bedspread. I thought, that's kind of strange. Where'd that wood come from on the bedspread? And I looked up, and right there above where I was sleeping, there was a hole in the ceiling. They had a wooden ceiling, and there was a hole there. And I looked over there right beside where I was sleeping, and there was a bullet laying there with a big dent in the wood. And the last night there, and I almost got shot. I believe an angel probably deflected that bullet, knocked it down, and the splinters fell on the thing. And so I thank the Lord that he takes care of you. The Bible tells us that all things will work together for good. God will take care of you in the midst of things. And, you know, I think when we get to heaven, we're going to be surprised of how many times God spared our life, and we didn't even know it. Didn't even know it. So then we went on to Honduras, packed up our stuff, went home, packed up all our stuff, bought a Jeep pickup truck, and moved to Honduras. When we got to Honduras, one of the things that happened when we got to Honduras was Hurricane Fifi had hit Honduras. the worst national disaster of the entire history of the country of Honduras. And right before that hurricane hit, we'd had a big citywide crusade. We worked with the national pastors, and it was really amazing because this little church run about 50, and we divided the young people, the teenagers, up into two groups. And the two groups would bring visitors, see who would bring the first visitors. Well, they had 50, regular 50 on Sunday. The first Saturday night, they had about 300. And then a second Saturday night, they went about 500-600. Then they did it for 6 weeks. At the end of 6 weeks, we had to move it outside into the parking lot area. And the last night, we had 1,700. They started renting. They didn't have any cars, but they started renting buses and saving money and renting buses. And this one little church brought 1,700 people. It was just unbelievable. What the work there. They were all excited about it and bringing all these people. I told the missionary there, I said, you know what? I said, if we could get 1,700 people with them working and bringing written buses and stuff, I said, we had four churches in the town, which is smaller than Mount Airy. We had four independent Baptist churches about every five blocks. And then we had another seven churches in the surrounding area. We had about 12, 15 churches in that whole area there. I said, if we get all these churches together, we could fill up that football stadium down there. So then we started working on a citywide crusade. And the next year we had a citywide crusade, had over 3,000 people each night. Now, this was a small town, had one paved road, okay, one paved road, two gas stations and two mom and pop things. And it was built on swamp. The town, the roads were dirt. And all on each side of the roads was swamp. You didn't buy land. You bought a piece of swamp. And some people didn't have enough money. So you buy this piece of swamp for your house, and then you get a dump truck and you'd fill it in with dirt and sand until you got the land above the water table, and then you build a house. Now, a lot of people did not have enough money to build a house and fill it in. It cost about $1,500 just to fill in the dirt and everything. So you know what they did, Dale? They didn't have enough money to fill in things, so they would just put down concrete posts. And then they would put the house over the swamp. Okay, little shack, you know, little wooden shack. And so if you put the concrete post down in this 3 feet of water here in this swamp, let me ask you a question. Where do you put the septic tank? They didn't put no septic. Okay, it just became open air sewage, and you would have 10 city blocks of these concrete posts down with no. And when I would go on visitation, they would put these little wooden bridges, one board for a bridge that would go to the house, to the road, to the next house, and you would have to walk on these boards to get up there to knock on the house. Well, sometimes, and now you remember, all the sewage is going down there in the swamp, okay, which is an awful, awful situation. So I was on visitation, Dale. You ever been on church visitation? Okay. So I'm out there walking on this narrow bridge, you know, and they don't keep them in very good repair, and I weigh 230, 40 pounds, okay, and I hit one of those boards, and wham! Right over in the sewage, you know. And it was terrible. Now, we rented a house. The house that we rented had land, had dirt under it, okay? But the house on both sides, they didn't have any dirt. They're just concrete posts, okay? And so what would happen with our house, where we had it dirt, you know, would be about 6 inches or a foot above the water table, is when you get the monsoon rains coming, then the sewage, it would raise the water table, and then the sewage would float through your yard, which was just an abominable, abominable situation from a health standpoint. It was so bad that we'd take special pills to kill the microbes and all this stuff. And then one time, my son, who was about 4 years old at the time, went to the bathroom, and he had a bowel movement. And in the bowel movement, you would see down there, there was a two-headed worm with two heads, brother, floating around there in the toilet. Scared my wife. Boy, we got him some medicine, get rid of all those worms and stuff. Two heads, man. Two-headed worm floating around in the sewage. What an awful. It's a miracle we ever made it through there. I had a great idea. It was around Thanksgiving time, so I was going to save money by raising a turkey instead of going and spending, you know, $50 for a turkey. I thought I would raise a turkey, so I went and bought a turkey for 10 bucks, and then I tried to raise it. The turkey wouldn't eat because turkeys are social animals. They've got to have other birds around or they won't eat. So the lady next door said, oh, well, put your turkey over here with my my chickens, and it'll be with other birds, and so it'll be happy, and it'll eat. So I put him over there, and then she fed my corn to her chickens and everything. I figured it up. I finally got this skinny turkey. Cost me about 50. Well, actually, then it was full of ticks. We had about 10,000 ticks all over the downstairs. I had to get $50 worth of special poison to kill all these ticks. My wife's scared to death they're going to get on Billy. And so I figured that turkey cost me about 150 bucks, brother, the time it was done. It weighed about 10 pounds. It was awful. So much for saving money. And then I said, when we had these two teenage groups with that 1,700 people, I said, we need to have a citywide crusade. So you got to imagine that. Now, here's a swamp town, swamp all over. You cannot imagine how bad it was. It was so bad that during the mosquito season, you would see a guy walking down the street from this distance, okay, and you could see 1,000 mosquitoes, like a swarm, around his head as he walked down the street. People, when you go there to preach, the people would there'd be so many mosquitoes in the church building, they'd be doing this. I mean, you can't imagine 150 people doing this. You know, slapping mosquitoes. So I told the pastor, I said, this is no good having 150 people out here swatting mosquitoes. And so I got two deacons, I went and bought two cans of Off. And then people would come and they would stand in the door, and the deacons would go down both, they go right down their arm, pshht, and down their legs. They go pshht, pshht, down their arm. You know, we had lost people. We had lost people who would come to church just so they could get sprayed for the night. You know, with the repellent, you know. But you know what? There was so much Off in that. It cost me $1.50, 75 cents a can. So $1.50, I didn't have no mosquitoes. And that thing, people would come, brother. They'd come in just to get sprayed for the night. And there was so much Off in there, the mosquitoes wouldn't even come in the building at all. They wouldn't even come in the building. And so I said, we need to get this group together and do this citywide crusade. And so they let us use the football stadium for free. I went out there and wired 200-watt lights in it. And it was amazing. We had 3,000 people each night. And what the churches did, the very poor church, nobody had a car, but they saved their money for a year, and they rented a bus for 4 days or 5 days to come down to the city football stadium. And, boy, it was amazing. We had 3,000 people each night. Now, we did have a problem. Some guy that was about half crazy got on there with a machete, and he wasn't going to let anybody off the bus. So we had to set up a control group to control anything. Then we had a Catholic lady got saved, and her husband came to the First Baptist Church in Puerto Cortez with a machete. He was drunk, and he was going to kill the pastor because his wife had become a Christian, and he didn't like it. And he goes, where's that pastor? Where's that pastor? I'm going to kill that pastor, you know. And let me get a gun. I've got my sword here. And so, you know, where's that pastor? He's going to kill him with a machete. So I said, this is no good. When I was in the psychiatric ward, we developed, and by the way, I would suggest, I always tell every pastor they ought to do this because you never know what's going to happen. And they have, when I was working in the hospital, we had a program where if somebody was out of control in the psychiatric ward, then we would they would call for all the orderlies to go to the psych ward stat. That means immediately. All orderlies to the psych ward stat. And then you would meet at the door before you went into the psychiatric ward, and the head orderly would say, okay, you got the right arm, you got the left arm, you got the right leg, you got the left leg, and you grab the head. And so what you do when a patient was out of control, and we had one patient there, he was skinny kid. I mean, just probably weighed 100, maybe 90 pounds, 100 pounds. And the doors in the psych ward were 2 inches thick, solid mahogany, and they had a steel grate embedded in the wood for a window. And this skinny guy with his fist, he went, bam! And he knocked the steel grate window clean out of the door, and then he grabbed the door and went and tore the door off the hinges, and the hinges were like you know, quarter-inch thick steel. You had three of them down there. I'm going, that was not natural, okay, to knock that out and take. And the guy was just a skinny, puny, you know, wasn't a football player, man. He tore a thing. The door was setting off the hinges. So he says, okay, you grab the right hand, you grab the left hand, you grab the left leg. So I trained the men, and we would do that. We'd go to the psychiatric ward, and we would surround the guy. And let me tell you something, Dale, I don't care how big somebody is. I don't care how strong he is, okay? Five men can control anybody if they don't have a weapon, you know, like a gun or a knife or something. But if it's just him, you get two guys grab this hand and two guys grab that hand, you ain't doing much. And once they grab your feet and take you off your feet, you have no strength when your feet's not on the ground. I mean, you'd be surprised how much no strength you have. I don't care how strong you are. And then they have another guy grab your head so you don't reach over and bite him, you know. And we've had to do that. And so I trained the men in our church in Puerto Cortez because these guys coming in there with machetes going to kill the pastor's First Baptist Church, wouldn't let people off the bus. I said, okay, you guys are the guys, okay, you five men. You get the right hand, left hand, right foot, left foot, and head, and get them out of here. And you do it without hurting them. You don't have to hit them and get a lawsuit. You just immobilize them and take them out of there. And it's a real good technique. They should teach that. They need to teach that in pastor school, Dale. So we're in Honduras. We had this great citywide crusade. And it was exciting. 3,000 people came each night. One man came forward and got saved who was an Apache Indian, a diesel engineer from America who was Apache Indian, who had married a Honduran woman, and he was down there visiting the in-laws, and he came to the crusade, and he got saved. And we just had some wonderful, wonderful times. And we had an independent Baptist church every 5 or 10 blocks, we had an independent Baptist church. So I told my wife, I said, you know, we set up a Bible Institute, we trained nationals, we went to the town of Rio Tinto. One of the black pastors came and said, Brother Haig, would you go with me down here to the town of Rio Tinto? He's a wonderful man. He spoke English. He spoke Spanish. We taught him Greek. We taught him Hebrew. And he spoke Caribbean, which was kind of a mix of Spanish and some other kind of language. But he spoke five languages, and he lived in a dirt house, had a dirt floor, thatch roof, you know, thatch sides, you know, it spoke five languages. And he was 70 years old, and Brother Jose Serrano went down to the town of Rio Tinto. And so many people, this is exciting, there's a small town like, I don't know, one of the small towns you got here, like White Plains, I'd say about like this, real small type place. How many houses do you think there are in White Plains? 100 houses? More? Huh? Okay, well, but, you know, I mean, it's not like Mount Airy, but it's a small town. And so many people, Dale, got saved that the bar closed down. Wonderful, you know. And what happened was one of the men was from that village, Rio Tinto, had gone to Detroit working the thing, and he had sent money down to build his bar, build his tavern, build his house and everything. And he was a big strapping big guy. And so his business was doing pretty good till Brother Jose Serrano went there and started preaching. All these people got saved, stopped going to the bar. And this guy came back from Detroit and found that this Baptist preacher had ruined his business. And so, buddy, he had got a gun, brother, and he would walk around with a gun through the town, and he'd grab people and said, are you a Christian? If you're a Christian, I'll blow your head off. And he'd go around there, he'd grab people and ask for their Christian. He was going to shoot them, you know, and he said, are you a Christian? I'll blow your head off. You people rule my business. And finally, the black pastor there was a great guy, he and his wife, they were having services in their house. And this guy was so mad, he went to the church service to disrupt the church service and said he's going to shoot them all. And the pastor's wife got mad that he was disrupting the service, that she hit him with her purse. Wham! Wham! And they kicked him out of there, you know. And so this guy goes down to the county seat, and he wants to sue the pastor's wife for assault and battery. And they thought, oh, no, Brother Haig, what are we going to do? This guy came. My wife hit him with a purse. She didn't hurt him. Okay, she didn't hurt him. And said, what are we going to do? And they were just, oh, what are we going to do? They're going to put us in jail. And so they went there and went before the judge. And this is one of those verses where it says, they meant that for our evil, but God turned it for our good. That's what Joseph said when they sent him down to prison, down to Egypt. He ended up being the prime minister over the whole place. They meant it for evil, but God turned it for good. And so they went before the judge and said, Judge, we're sorry. He said, we were having this church service, and this man came in. He said, what? You were having a church service, and this man came in and interrupted your church service? Yeah, Judge, we're sorry. And he called such a thing. He said, whoa, whoa, whoa. He said, how dare you go into a church? He said, and by the way, I think every country that I know of, they have a law against sacrilege. Do you know what that means? The law of sacrilege is you cannot go to somebody's church or synagogue or place of worship during their regular church services and cause a disruption. You can't not go out here in front of White Plains Baptist Church and set off firecrackers in the street. Ordinarily, you're allowed to set off firecrackers in the street, but you can't do it in front of the church during church services because that is sacrilege. It's against the law. You're interrupting their regular church service. And he told that guy, he said, listen, I'm going to put you in jail. This is a guy that was suing him, you know. He said, don't you ever bother those people in that town again, you know. And they came back rejoicing, said, thank the Lord, that the judge found in our favor. Now this guy, he came that close to going to jail for a long time. I mean, the judge was furious that he didn't care what they did to him, but he was furious that he would go in there and interrupt a church service. And so we had a great time in Honduras. Had lots of people saved. Hurricane Fifi came through there and buried just before we left. They had the worst national disaster of the entire history of the country. Hurricane Fifi came in there in the middle of the night, and there were four towns that were the four centers of witchcraft in Honduras. I can't remember the names of them right now, but they were all right near where we were, and those towns were buried in the middle of the night. Right before Hurricane Fifi had hit, the one man came to our house and he started hollering at 4 o'clock in the morning, Pastor, Pastor, come quick. And in English, so we went down and talked to him, and he said he was in one of these towns and they were sacrificing cats and dogs to the devil. And he said he was certain that they were going to use him as a human sacrifice. He was physically trembling. I mean, he was just going like this. And I talked to him. I said, well, sir, first of all, you need to make sure you're saved. And somebody had given him a marked New Testament. I went through the plan of salvation. He got saved. And I said, now you go. He was a merchant marine. I said, you get back on your merchant marine ship and you leave. Okay. So you get out of here. And so he left. And Hurricane Fifi came through there, buried those four towns alive in the middle of the night, four centers of witchcraft. And then shortly after that, we moved to Guatemala. And we just had a wonderful time there. A lot of people got saved. We had a chance to start four churches in Rio Tinto, in Puente Alto, Baracoa. And we started with three churches there. And then God dealt with us because we had church every 10 blocks. So I said, we need to go on to Guatemala. So the next time we went on to Guatemala, and we'll tell you about that next. Okay, this is chapter 2, or the second missionary journey, dealing with the communist trying to overthrow the government of Guatemala. My wife and I have been missionaries 43 years, and after we went to San Jose, Costa Rica to study Spanish, where we had the Russians by the embassy next door, and a lot of unusual things happened, then we went on to Honduras, had a great ministry there, have started three churches, had hundreds of people saved, set up a Bible Institute. Then we went on to the country of Guatemala. Now, one of the things that I do is I do gospel magic. I don't like calling it magic. These are actually object lessons. And so this allowed me to get into a lot of different places where ordinarily they wouldn't let you just come to preach. And so I use these object lessons all the time, and what I really like are these fire. I do a lot of fire magic, fire tricks. And Let me give you an example here. For example, the Bible says you are the light of the world. Can you zoom in here on my light bulb? Okay. You're the light of the world. So you have this light. And I want you to know there's nothing in this hand. But the Bible is a light. And so you take the Bible, you take the light from the Bible, and God will put it in your heart. And this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. And you don't want to let Satan blow it out, because the devil will try to take the light away. But God wants you to shine till Jesus comes. And then one of these days, Jesus will come and we will all disappear. Let me do this one here. The Bible, there are good things about the Bible if you do right, and there are bad things about the Bible if you do wrong. If you do right, the Bible is like gold. So here we have more desirable than much fine gold. And it says, desiring the sincere milk of the word. If you do right, it's like gold. It's like milk. It's like honey. But if you do wrong, dun, 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 there are some negative things about the Bible. He says, is not my word like a hammer? Yeah, the Bible is like a hammer. And not only that, the Bible is like a fire. I don't want the fire. I want the gold and the silver, the milk and the honey. There are positive things about the Bible when you do right. There are negative things about the Bible when you do wrong. Let me do this one here. I have my assistant here with me. We did this last night. I want you to notice here, we'll take this here. Open this box. And as you can see, there's nothing in the box. Okay, we can turn it upside down, nothing in the box. Okay, we're going to take the box here. It appears that nothing's in the box. So we're going to take this, and we'll put some lighter fluid in it. Okay, put that in there like that. And then we're going to take this piece of flash paper. We're going to throw this in here. And there it is, the flaming coffin of death. What are the magic words? Please and thank you. And so when we open the coffin, here is my assistant. Notice there's nothing in here, no secret compartment. And here is my assistant, Miss Snowflake. Come here, Miss Snowflake. Here she is. Miss Snowflake, how do you do those things? She said, it's a secret. It's a secret. Okay, let me put her over here in her, might get a little squeal. Let me put her over here in her little cage. This is my assistant, Miss Snowflake. She helps me in all these programs. We go to church. So one of the things we use, I want to do that because I use these object lessons a lot when I go in Honduras and Guatemala. We moved to Guatemala. We moved right next door to Bob Enriquez, who is a professional magician, and he showed me how to do a lot of unusual things, and so I use these all the time. Another thing that we use is I do paintings, and I do these baptistry paintings. We did this one here at White Plains Baptist Church, and this is one of the paintings. If you zoom in on that, okay, this is one of the paintings. I've actually painted this picture four times bigger than this, actually covering from wall to wall and twice that high. But this is a nice size, and I painted over, I guess, probably 200 murals like that with the mountains and the river in baptistry paintings. So when we went to Guatemala, I had a child evangelism worker say to me, Brother Hague, said, we used to go out and do special programs. We do gospel magic, do chalk art. I also do chalk art, and we'll talk about that later. And do some visual aids and show movies and stuff. And he said, I used to carry a bus around with me. It was a white bus with a little steeple on it. We'd just have a little handful of people, kids that would come. He said, then I hit on the idea of passing out tickets. So I go all over the neighborhood, passing out tickets to these children, and we would pack that bus out. I said, man, that's amazing. I said, you know what? I'm going to do that. I told my wife, I said, let's do that. So we went to Guatemala, had moved in there, was working with a Libby Cooper, and she said, well, I go over and do these child evangelism classes at this school. Why don't you come with me and do some gospel magic things and do a little chalk art? And so I went to the school, and so we talked to them about letting us use the school on Sunday for special programs. And they said, oh, yeah, you can come here and use the school. It had a big patio. Matter of fact, the patio was about as big as this auditorium. It was a huge patio, and then they had classrooms all around the outside. And so we took all the chairs out of the classrooms, put them in the center, set up a stage, and I would do some chalk art. I would draw on paper with colored chalk, and we would show movies on Sunday night, and we'd do different things. And the first, I told my wife, I said, we're going to go around and pass out tickets. So our children were all real small. I think Billy was probably 6 maybe or so, but there was about a 10-year-old boy that we'd got to know over in that area of Zone 6. And so he and I would go and pass out tickets. And we had 400 people the first Sunday come to that school. That was amazing. I had all these people out there, man, and I was doing chalk drawing. We had, 20, 30 people come forward on the invitation and get saved. The first Sunday, we had 400. The second Sunday, we had 750. The third Sunday, we had 1,200, and the end of the month, we were running 1,500. And it was just me and about a 10-year-old boy. We would go around and pass out tickets for church. It was, it really was just a small announcement, but I've got a ticket, I'm going to go. And so we were able to rent a theater building in that area, and we were having 800 people on a regular basis come there. While we were there, had a great time getting into the public schools and setting up a Bible Institute to train nationals. And while we were working there in the city of Guatemala, the capital city, the communists tried to overthrow the government. And there was a government, there was a communist invasion, and six men showed up with machine guns next door to where we were looking for a friend of ours. And with machine guns, they were looking for him, another missionary friend of ours. And we told the missionary staying at our house while we were gone, I said, now look, don't have any of that anti-communist literature that you've been passing out in our house. Because if they break in this house, because you're an American, and they see that literature, they will kill you and they'll burn this house down with all of our furniture and everything in here, right, all my books and everything. And don't you have that literature in there. And so a friend of ours came to visit our house, and as he was standing there knocking on the door, he said, right across the street, a guy walked up to this guy and shot and killed him right there in the street. And the maid grabbed him and pulled him in and said, get in here. Said, they'll think you're a they'll think you're a witness. They might shoot you. And so they put him. He said he was driving around the freeway. They have a freeway around Guatemala City. Now, Guatemala City, there's live volcanoes on the outside of Guatemala City. You can see fire coming out of the volcanoes at night. And he said while they were there, he said he was driving around the freeway and he saw a van in front of him. It looked like people were up walking around in the van, moving around. And he said, I wonder what they're doing there, driving around the freeway 60 miles an hour. And all of a sudden, the back doors of the van opened and they shoved the dead body out in the street and said he had to swerve to miss the dead body. And it was really very, very dangerous. Brother Green was going down to show a film in one of the churches down, and it's called the Seis de Mayo or something like that. It wasn't Cinco de Mayo, that's a Mexican holiday, but it was like the 6th of May. From people from an earthquake or something, they set up this little town for these refugees. And he was going to go there, and he said, listen, how do you get to that Seis de Mayo place? And they said, oh, no, don't go there. He said, well, yeah, I'm supposed to show this film in that church there. No. And finally, he stopped the policeman. He said, he's over in the general area. Guatemala City is a large city of over 3 million people. And he stopped and he said, listen, where's the 6th of May place? They said, oh, no, the policeman said, we don't even go over there. It's too dangerous. And he said, well, no, I'm supposed to show a film there. So finally, he found out where it was, stopped two girls. And they said, well, it's down that path there. You can't drive. You got to walk down there. And he said, well, I'm not going to carry my big old heavy movie projector down that narrow little path there down in that slum area. And so he started to walk down. He said, I'll leave my movie projector in the car. So he started to walk down there. And he said, when he walked down this narrow path, two men stepped out behind him. And he could hear them walking behind him. And he thought, oh, and he said, I'm going to carry a gun. He had a pistol he carried with him. And he pulled out, he put his hand on his pistol. And as he was walking down that path, started getting dark. And he could hear these two guys weren't walking. Now they were running. And as they ran up on him there, he could hear. And he turned around like that, and they were just about to hit him over the head with a club. And he slammed them against the wall, and he took off running back up the hill. And they took two shots to try to discourage them from coming after him. And they took off when they found out he had a gun. His wife, they had a motorhome. We rented this house in the Capitol, and the next street over, right against the lot that we were renting, there was a vacant lot. So he rented the vacant lot, and he put his camper in there. It had a wall all the way around. It had water, electricity. So he had his camper there, and it was cheaper than renting a house. And his wife was in there, and he taught her how to use the gun. And one day, in the middle of the afternoon, some thief jumped over the wall. You know, because it was locked, and it's 8-foot wall. This guy jumped over the wall, and so she came out with a pistol. She said, "Hey, bud, just get back over the wall, get out of here." And he didn't think she could use it, so he started to come at her, and she went, "Bam, bam!" Took 2 shots at his feet. He thought it'd be a better idea to go over the wall, so he went back over the wall. So it was really a very, very dangerous situation. We had a missionary there, a friend of ours named Larry Boggs. And I told him, I said, "Larry, you know, the communists are out there in those hills there. They're trying to overthrow the government here in Guatemala." I said, "You better get out of there." "Oh, no, Brother Haig." Said, "They know that I'm not involved in all this politics stuff. I'm just out here trying to get folks saved. I don't care what they do with their politics." And so he didn't come. Then one day he had a pastor visiting from the States. And the pastor was probably about 40. And he had his 70-year-old retired father pastor with him. So this retired pastor and this pastor was very visiting Larry Boggs out in this mountains, and he said they were sitting in their living room talking and everything, and he looked outside. They didn't have a wall around their house or anything like they do down in the Capitol. And he looked outside, and it looked like some kids were playing hide and seek in the bushes. So he went over, and he saw this kid down in his bushes, and he got down there. He said, "Hey, what are you doing in my bushes? And you guys playing?" And the guy put a machine gun in his face and said, "Get back in the house." So he said, "Those aren't kids. There's something going on. Those guys got guns out there." And so they started praying. They had a long prayer meeting. And those communists had put a bomb on the top of his house. And I mean, about 1 o'clock, boom, man. I mean, the whole thing blew up. And by the grace and mercy of God, nobody was hurt. But he and his wife were going to sleep on a mattress in his office, and that's right where they put the bomb up there, where he had a ham radio, and they might have thought he was a spy station or something. And the 2x4s from the roof went right through the mattress into the concrete floor. And the police, there was a police station about a block and a half away, and the police didn't even come to investigate till the next morning about 10 o'clock. And Brother Boggs said, "No, we got to get out of here. They're going to blow up our house." And thank God nobody was hurt, had a few scratches, but they came back into the Capitol. And so the communists were trying to overthrow the government in Guatemala. While we were home on furlough, it just got worse. And so I told my wife, they had declared martial law. You could not have any church services. We were having great church service, so we had a national pastor. We turned the church over to the national pastor, and then we went on to Puerto Rico. And we just had a wonderful time there in Guatemala. We went back and had a citywide crusade. I used some gospel magic. I used this one here. We used this. This is an object lesson here. I like this thing here. The balancing eagle. And the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, "They that wait upon the Lord shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." But notice this eagle can actually balance and not fall on your finger, just like that. See there, it won't fall. And it's based on the law of the center of gravity. It has lead weights in the end of the wings, and because of that, it will not fall because the center of gravity is actually back here. The weight is not here. It looks like it's here, but it's actually the weight is here. And that's a great illustration of center of gravity. So we went back to Guatemala several years later. I told Brother Crane, I said, "We need to go to Guatemala and have a citywide crusade." They built a $20 million football stadium about a block and a half from our church that we had started there in Guatemala. I said, "We need to go down there and help them." So we got the group together, got a team together, went back to Guatemala, and it was really amazing. We were able to get into 32 public schools. And what I would do is I'd walk up with this little scientific object lesson on the law of the center of gravity, and we'd walk up to a public school, just cold turkey, no appointment, no nothing, and I would go in and talk to the principal. I said, "Look, we're having a big citywide crusade out here, and we'd like to do a special program at your school using these object lessons." This one is based on the law of the center of gravity. Okay, now what? This thing will bounce. Matter of fact, I'll tell you what I would tell the principal. If you will stop school, could you imagine doing this in America? If you will stop school and let us speak to the children for about 15 minutes and show them some of these object lessons, I will give you this little object lesson on the law of the center of gravity. She said, you're going to give me that? I will give it to you. They're very, very expensive, but I will give it to you. I didn't tell her, but I bought them in Mexico for 50 cents a piece, okay? And I had about 100 of them. I said, I'll give you one of these. So they would stop the school, bring in 120 students, and we would go through and preach and do a little chalk talk thing for them, give the invitation. The first, we did on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, the first Monday, we had like 1,200 children that prayed and asked Jesus to save them. And the next time we had over 2,000, then we had another something like 1,200. And by the end of those 3 days, we had spoken in about 15 public schools, I think it was 19 public schools, and we had had over 5,000 boys and girls pray and ask Jesus to save them by just giving away a 50-cent object lesson to the principal of the school. Then each night we had a baseball stadium, and we'd have 2,000 or 3,000 people each night. It was just a tremendous time. I did an 8-foot by 12-foot chalk drawing on the Great White Throne Judgment, and we had over 2,000 saved in the evening services, and we had over 5,000 saved in the public school. It was just a tremendous, tremendous opportunity. We have a missionary there, Brother Doyle Roberts, and he just recently came home. While he was there, he's from our home church in Pensacola, and while he was there, he started developing heart trouble, and his heart stopped 3 times. He was clinically dead 3 times. They had to put a pacemaker in his heart, and fortunately were able to revive him, and he's now back in Pensacola serving the Lord. So we had a great time then in Guatemala, our second missionary thing. While we were in Guatemala, Brother Crane, no, it's actually, then we moved on from Guatemala. They had the Civil War come out, and so we were praying about what to do. They had declared martial law where you could not have any gatherings in the evening. Now, we would have 90 people, 60 to 90 for Sunday school, but on Sunday evening, we would have 500 or 600. And the reason was everybody would go to the market on Sunday from about 8 o'clock till about noon, and at 12 o'clock, the market would close down. And so everybody had to buy their food for the week at the market, to save money. And so we had, our big service was in the evening. So I told my wife, I said, I'm not going to go back to Guatemala and just sit there to see if the communists are going to succeed in overthrowing the government. Fortunately, the government, the people in Guatemala, realizing the communists were gaining ground because of the government corruption, they took one of the generals there who was a Christian. He's a member of Charismatic Church, but he is a Bible-believing Christian. And they made him president. They had a coup, made him president, and he started teaching the Bible in the public from the television. Every once a week, he would teach Bible class on television, and made the officials start doing right. And the communists then lost credibility, and they were able to prevent the communists from overtaking the government. While we were wondering what to do, Brother Green called me and said, "Listen, there's a great opportunity to serve the Lord in Puerto Rico." And so then we went on, did deputation, reported all our churches, and told him we were going on to Puerto Rico. I was going to Puerto Rico to help him teach Greek and an introduction to Hebrew in the Bible Institute there with Dr. Mike Casillas, and to start churches. And so then we moved on to Puerto Rico, our third missionary trip. Yeah, I want to be sure and mention the two things with Brother Green. We worked with Brother Claude Green in Guatemala City while we were there, and one of the things that happened to him, he went up on the side of a volcano to show a film, and it was on a live volcano. I mean, there's fire coming out of that thing, and these people are, they're only maybe half a mile away, and he said to me on this plantation, he said, "Don't you people think it's a little dangerous living up here, going to bed at night with fire coming out of that volcano right over there, not too far away?" They said, "Oh, no, man." He said, "The lava came here in the yard not too long ago, about 2 weeks ago." Said, we're okay. And it's kind of, you say, how could somebody do that? It's when you're around danger, you develop an insensitivity to the real danger that's around you. And it's really amazing. One time Brother Green was going to show a film, and I was telling Dale that he's going to show a film out in this one village. It's very Catholic, and the men had gotten drunk, and they were going to go up there and disturb the service. So while he had a generator running, they went over while they're showing the film, the Burning Hell movie, and the guy was cutting the wire, the electric cord, with a machete. And every time they come down, it would make the contact, and the movie would run. And when they picked the machete up, the projector would go off. And then they come down and with a machete and hit that electric cord, and it would, the steel would make contact, and the movie would go on. And then they realized, this is really too dangerous. And so we better just get out of here. So they picked up their generator, picked up their movie projector, put it back up in their truck, and they started to drive away, and they stoned their truck and the people in. I mean, these Catholics were throwing rocks at him. The women, children got hit with rocks and put a bunch of dents in his car, but fortunately, by the grace of God, they got out of there. Amen. So Guatemala was a great opportunity. Had a lot of folks saved, but it was not a picnic with the communists showing up, people being shot at. And a man was shot, one of our neighbors was killed. Another man was shot right in front of our house. Six men with machine guns showed up at Brother Green's house. And it was really a very, very dangerous situation. So then we moved on. Our next term, we went and reported our churches. Then we went on to Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico has to be one of the most unusual places I've ever been. First of all, Puerto Rico is a center for UFO activity. I know some of the brethren don't like that. But what I've noticed with some preachers and some religious organizations, their problem isn't with what's going on. Their problem is they don't like what the Bible says. That's their real problem. And, you know, I feel sorry for them, you know. I made up my mind a long time ago that I don't care what anybody thinks. If God said it, that settles it. Amen. You may not like it for me to get up here and make some comment about flying things flying through the air, but I always ask myself the question, what does the Bible say? Now, I personally have never seen any UFOs, okay, just tell you that, but I have a lot of friends, close personal friends, reliable people who have, and if you want to know what the Bible says about it, turn to Zechariah chapter 5, verse 1. And in Zechariah chapter 5, verse 1, it says this, "And I lifted up mine eyes, and behold, a flying roll." He said, there was for real an object flying through the air. And he said, this angel asked Zechariah, "What do you see?" And he said, "I see this thing flying through the air." He said, "What is it?" It says, "It is a curse." It says down in verse 8, "It is wickedness." It is a demonic manifestation. Now, you can like that or not like that, but that's what the Bible says. You know, I think some of these organizations, I thought about some organizations having to make this into a movie, but I said, when they get the thing about the UFOs in Puerto Rico, Bob Jones University staff would freak out. Oh, we can't handle that. You know what the problem is? They can't handle the Bible. That's what their problem is. They never could handle it, okay? They can't handle it today, they couldn't handle it yesterday, and they won't be able to handle it tomorrow. Listen, if the Bible says it, that settles it. Amen? So I just slipped that in there. So we went to Puerto Rico. I went there to teach Greek in the Bible college there. Dr. Mike Casillas asked me to come down there and help him to teach in the Bible Institute. And I taught there for a couple years. I taught Greek and advanced theology. And we started a church in Puerto Rico. And I was very unusual that Puerto Rico, first of all, is a center for UFO activity. And then second of all, it's part of the Bermuda Triangle. So if you want to know why I'm so strange, I lived in the Bermuda Triangle for 10 years. Amen. That's why I'm talking about all these demons and stuff. And so I started doing some research on this thing of these things flying through the air, these demonic manifestations. Now, I do not believe in extraterrestrials, okay? The Bible makes it very clear there are only three types of intelligent beings. God exists in his angels, the devil exists in his angels, you and I are here, and there is nobody else. There are no extraterrestrial beings that are not either angels, demons, or people, okay? Not in the Bible, there isn't. Well, what about E.T.? I had a man in Guatemala ask me, said, well, what if there was E.T. up there? I said, okay, let's suppose he's up there. He said, well, what if it's up there? I said, well, the Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10, if he's up there, he's going to burn. The heavens will pass away with a great noise. The elements will smelt with fervent heat. The earth and the works therein shall be burned up. So we're in Guatemala, and we started a church in Carolina. Had a great opportunity to have a Christian day school that we started there. And then I started going around when I was teaching in the Bible college. And if you'll turn to the map of Puerto Rico there. And you scan over there to that map, it's number 3. Okay? If you'll scan to the map there in Puerto Rico, we went all around the island preaching. We had probably about 3,000 saved all around, going with the Bible college students and preaching there all over the island, okay? Then you come back up here. So we had a great opportunity working with the Bible Institute students, and we started a church there in Puerto Rico. And while I was going all around the island, we went down to the town of Fajardo, and we had a friend there. We have a friend that was in Fajardo named Claude and Jan Green, and they were down there, and we got up there. I think it was around either Thanksgiving or Christmas, we're going to have dinner with them. And Mrs. Green, who is a very level-headed person. Matter of fact, right now he is pastoring a church up here near Greenville, South Carolina. And his wife said, Brother Hague, said, you're not going to believe what happened. I said, well, what happened? She said, well, I'm sitting here and I was looking out the window and this flying object came flying by over here out in the ocean. And the airplanes from the Air Force base not too far away came out to investigate. And when they did, the thing went down in the water. And then the airplanes didn't find anything, so they left. And the thing just appeared again, right there it was, flying right there, out there over the ocean. The airplanes came out again to investigate. Thing went down in the water. The airplanes went out. She said, I sat here for 30 minutes watching this thing go in and out of the water. Said, I can't believe my own eyes. You know, she's a very level-headed. His wife is a very level-headed person. We had the pastor in the town of, trying to think of the name, it's on the other side of the island. He had a big Christian school. This guy was a professional musician, played in a band before he became pastor, before he was called to preach. And he said, Brother Hague, he said, before I was called to preach, he said, me and our music group was going to go out and play a concert in this some event. And he said, we're going down the highway, and one of these flying objects came right down beside our car. Matter of fact, we thought it hit the car. I mean, you know, we're not talking about looking something way off. So that thing, we thought it hit the car. And said, man, we stopped and got out and looked. And the thing just took off. And then our doctor, Dr. Vargas, medical doctor, okay, this ain't some, you know, the National Enquirer or something. Medical doctor, and he was in the town of Adjuntas. And he said, spoke English fluently. He's licensed to practice medicine in the United States, a very solid Christian man. I think he's a deacon in his church. He said, I was in Adjuntas, and this thing came down on the hotel, and said, there are 500 witnesses. And I have a documentary. We may put this on the video, a documentary about the UFO that came down on the ball field and on the city square in the town of Adjuntas. And I asked the people at the Independent Baptist Church in Adjuntas, I said, okay, they said this happened in, 1972 or something. And I said, now, is there anybody here? Were you here? I think 1972, I'll have to look up at the date on that. When that thing came down in the city square here, and there's 500 people out here there's a junior league baseball thing. I said, is there anybody here that was here when this happened? And I showed the movie, the 15-minute documentary on it, reenactment. And they said, yes, sir, Brother Hague. People in the church now, we were here, and it happened just like the movie, the documentary reenactment you just showed. It happened just like that. We were here. I had 5 people say that. Okay. So I have never seen a UFO. I do not want to see a UFO, okay, because I think they're demonic in nature. And so I don't want to have anything to do with it, okay? But I have friends, medical doctor, pastor, missionaries who have seen those things. Then Puerto Rico is also part of the Bermuda Triangle. And right in front of San Juan, Puerto Rico, is an area. I was teaching, and it's kind of unusual because I don't trust people. And I'm not very... not very gullible. I don't trust anybody. I like to check everything out. Amen. I don't care who says it. And so this one student in the Bible college, he said, Dr. Hague, he said, have you ever studied the Bermuda Triangle and the Bible? I said, what? He said, have you ever studied the Bermuda Triangle and the Bible? I said, No, man, there, and I said this to him, I said, there ain't nothing in the Bible on the Bermuda Triangle. And, he, you know, I mean, hey, listen, I've read the Bible all the way through in English. Amen? Haven't found any errors, contradictions, mistakes. I've read the Bible all the way through in Spanish, mostly. I've gone through the New Testament in Greek. I used to have my devotions at Bob Jones University every day. I go through the Greek New Testament. And then I've gone through parts of the Old Testament, Hebrew. I haven't found any errors in English, Spanish, Greek, Hebrew, Russian, or any other language. The Bible has no mistakes in it. And I told him, I haven't found anything on the Bermuda Triangle. He said, well, he said, the Bible says that he that answers a matter before he hears it, it is shame and folly unto him. There are a lot of Christians in some ultra-conservative groups who get up and make statements that have that are completely contrary to the Bible, but they don't care. You know, they're trying to fit in with their group. They don't care what the Bible says. And so I said, okay, buddy. He said, so you need to check it out. I said, all right, just to accommodate you, I'm going to check it out. But I'm going to tell you, there's nothing in the Bible on the Bermuda Triangle. So I started going through there and reading, and I found out there's a 500-page book called The Bermuda Triangle in the Bible. I have it in English. I have it in Spanish, 500 pages. Somebody else, not me, somebody else, 500 pages, The Bermuda Triangle in the Bible. And then I started going through there and checking out, and I guess one of the most unusual things is to find out that the area that I've ever learned from the Bible is find that the area that we call the Bermuda Triangle is specifically referred to in the Bible. To me, that's amazing. I've been studying the Bible for over almost 45, 50 years, and to find out that that area is referred to. Now, it's not called the Bermuda Triangle. That's some invention, you know, the people come up with. But the term in the Bible is the deep and the great deep. And when you look that up in Hebrew, it does not mean a deep place. It means the deepest place in the ocean, the deep, the great deep. Where is the deepest place in the ocean? The deepest place is right in front of San Juan, Puerto Rico, where we lived. We live right there in Carolina, right there in San Juan. And it is the Puerto Rican, it's called the Puerto Rican Trench, and it goes 5.2 miles straight down in the ocean. That is the deep that the Bible talks about. You want to see something, you need to read what that Bible says about the ocean and the sea and the deep. And there's some really, I ended up with 7 pages of Bible notes on the Bible and the Bermuda Triangle. The deep is referred to in Psalm 42, verse 7. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us there are two of them. It says in Psalm 42, verse 7, it says, the deep, one, calleth unto the deep, two, the waves are passed, billows are passed over me. And there are two of them, and there just happen to be two of them. The deepest place in the Atlantic Ocean is the Puerto Rican Trench right in front of San Juan, Puerto Rico, where we lived for 10 years. And then on the exact opposite side of the earth is the Mariana Trench, and that's called the Dragon's Triangle, and I have a documentary on that. I don't think I've shown that here. I didn't show that on the Dragon's Triangle. Here at Mount Air. I have to show that sometime. And it's only about 15, 20 minutes long. But on the exact opposite side is the Mariana Trench. That is the deepest place in the Pacific Ocean. It is 6.8 miles deep. Now, the crust of the earth at sea level is basically about 12 to 20 miles thick. Now, where is hell? The Bible says, and they descended into hell, and they went down into hell. Hell beneath is moved for thee. I had the people in Guatemala tell me, he said, you know, Brother Haig, we got these volcanoes. They got the smoking volcano, smoke coming out of that thing. Over here on the other side, they have the fire volcano, El Volcán de Fuego, and they have, I mean, fire, brother, coming out of that thing. You drive around the freeway in Guatemala City, and at night it's fire coming out of that thing. And, you know, now it's quite a few miles away, but you can flat see it, man, see the fire coming out of that thing. And I had people in Guatemala said, we believe that Guatemala is the gate to hell. I said, you do? He said, yeah, see that fire coming out? See that smoke coming out of there? It says fire and smoke in hell. And the Bible says even nature itself is set on fire of hell. And so the crust of the earth is about 12 miles thick. So if you go in the Puerto Rican Trench, let's say it's 12 miles in Puerto Rico, and you go down 5 miles in the Puerto Rican Trench, you're only 7 miles from a literal, physical, burning hell. I mean, for real. and you get over there in the Puerto Rican church, you're only like 5 miles from hell. So the Bible talks about the gates of hell, plural. And you know, there's more than one. So there might be two of them. Might be one in Puerto Rico, one over there, and that might be where the... I told him Puerto Rico, I believe the Antichrist is coming here first. he says he comes up out of the bottomless pit. He might be coming up through the Puerto Rican Trench or out over the Mariana Trench. I couldn't prove that, but that might be the case. So we worked in Puerto Rico, went around there, taught in the Bible college. Then we started a church in Carolina, and we started a Christian day school. And we had a lot of people saved. And then I had a chance to teach, go as a chaplain in the prison. And we had some unusual things happen in the prison. Every Sunday I'd preach and I'd do chalk drawings. And then what I'd do, I'd have them on paper. So I would roll them up on Sunday, the Sunday morning, Sunday night. I'd just roll them up, the paper, and I'd take them to the jail on Monday. And we every Monday morning, it was different. Dale, I've never said, I know you preach in jail. Every Monday, something different happened, brother. And we would go there on Monday. Now, what we do, they had a giant castle up on a mountain. There's big white castle on the mountain. And they had 7,000 prisoners in that prison. And it was a great opportunity, and I would go right in. They would put me right in, just leave me there alone, you know. And they had two sides. We would always go and preach to the people that got arrested over the weekend that hadn't made bail yet. We was doing it on Sunday, Wednesday, and Friday, but I found by Friday everybody was gone. So we just went on Monday. We get everybody hadn't made bail yet and hadn't got you know, they get drunk or drunken driving or some disturbance, and they'd be in there. And so I'd put those chalk drawings on the wall and just tape them on the wall, and then I'd preach them about 10 minutes in Spanish, give an invitation. We'd always have between 20 and 50, sometimes 75 saved on Monday. It was great. I mean, most pastors, Monday is a downer, you know. Things didn't go too good on Sunday. But for me, Monday was always the upper. Because if nobody got saved in Sunday, which many times we didn't have people saved in our church, but we always have between 10 and 50 saved every Monday in the jail. And I remember one time went in there, and I'd leave. I'd put it on this side, and then I'd go say, okay, let me go on the other side. That'd be like if we go in the dining area, there'd be about 50, 20 men there. And then we go to the other side, and there'd be 50 or 20 men. And every Monday, it was different. Something weird would happen. And I remember one time the guy was a Roman Catholic who was the jailer there. He said, well, preacher, you want to go in there? Said they stabbed a guy yesterday. They stabbed him. Yeah, they'd take a spoon and they'd file it down on the brick, you know, and make a knife out of a spoon handle and then stab somebody. I said, yeah, I weigh 250 pounds. I'm 6'3", and I always stand with my back to the wall. Or whatever, and I do a chalk drawing like that, you know. But I'll never forget it. So we went in there, we had a couple saved that Sunday, and then one time I had Dr. Marion Gothard, who went with us, another missionary, great friend, and he was an older missionary, and so he would go with me, and he didn't know much Spanish, so I would translate for him. And so Marion Gothard came to our church, and he was up in his 65, and 10 years earlier he had a brain tumor, and the tumor had then come, 10 years later, had come back and was sticking out his head, starting to protrude out of the back of his head. And he went to one missionary and said, look, I'd like you to anoint me with oil, like it says in the book of James, and pray for me. And the guy said, no, that's that Pentecostal stuff. We don't do that. No, that's not Pentecostal. That's the book of James. The Bible says, is any sick? Okay, it says don't go look for some great healer like Benny Hinn. I just read 2 days ago that Benny Hinn's wife is suing him for divorce. You know, just read that. It was in the newspaper the day before yesterday. His wife suing him for. I said the Bible said don't go look for Oral Roberts or Benny Hinn or some great healer. The Bible says if any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the local church. I'm a local church man. I start local churches. Amen. And let him call for the local church and let them anoint him with oil and pray with. We do that. Somebody's sick, I'll anoint him. Let me tell you something. When I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, buddy. The first thing I did was not go to the clinic in Atlanta. First thing I had the church come together, I had the men pray for me, anoint me with oil. Amen. That's what the Bible says. And so then you do whatever else you can do. So I did that first. And so he said, would you pray for me? I said, yes, sir, brother. We'll have a service, anoint you with oil and pray for you. And so he came one Sunday night, and we had a special prayer, had the men come around there, anointed him with oil, prayed for him, and the tumor, the brain tumor, went away. Amen? I know God does miracles. I've seen God do miracles. I don't believe in the miracle healers. Amen? I believe in the miracle God. When we were in Guatemala, what I just mentioned last time, when we started in the school, we had to leave the school because it was a political year and they didn't want people having political rallies, so they wouldn't let anybody have anything in a school. So we had to rent a small building for a short time until we got the big theater to hold a lot of people. And we rented a small building, and this lady who owned the building lived right next door, and she said, look, Pastor Haig said, would you pray for me? So they have found a tumor in her abdomen, and said, they already have me scheduled for surgery. Would you pray for me? I said, yes, sir. So I got a couple of the men. We went over to her house, and we prayed for her. We anointed her with oil. We prayed for her and asked, that God would take that and make the tumor disappear. I believe miracles. Amen. And so right now I'm praying for a miracle. This friend of ours, they said he has colon cancer. He's going to die. I worked in a hospital. And I've seen cases in that hospital where people, they said, this man will never make it. This person is going to die. And I've seen those people leave the hospital well, walking, talking, and well, leave the hospital, who the doctor said would never live. Okay, they'll never make it out of here. And so this lady in Guatemala, she said, would you pray for me? We went over, we prayed for her. You know what? I didn't see any flashing lights. I didn't hear any bells ring. We just prayed for her in faith. Amen. So she went to the hospital the next day to get the tumor taken out. And they said, okay, let's take an x-ray and see if that thing is, how much more that thing has grown. And when they took an x-ray, guess what? The tumor was gone. They said, well, the machine must not be working right. Let's go to another. They took it to another machine, took another x-ray. Guess what? The tumor was gone. They canceled the operation. Amen. I've seen God do miracles, okay? So, don't tell me. I've been there. Now let me tell you something. We had this guy called Yee Davila. I won't insert this about this miracle stuff. When God heals people in the Bible, he always does it in a natural way when it's divine healing. You got that? You understand what I just said? When the guy was blind, Jesus did not give the blind man special glasses made by men. Amen? When the guy was lame, Jesus didn't give him an artificial leg. Amen? He healed him with a natural means. Now, I say that because we had this healer coming through there, and they had this tract passing out and said, yes, come down to our healing service because God filled my teeth with gold. I had cavities, and God filled my teeth with gold. Now, let me ask you, looking at the Bible way when divine healing occurs, does God use artificial means to heal people? No. He didn't give the blind guy glasses. He didn't give the lame guy an artificial leg. And he doesn't fill people's teeth with gold either. I had one lady tell me, she said, yes, sir, said, you see that? He prayed for me and God filled. I said, listen, lady, if my own mother told me that God filled her teeth with gold, I'd say, I'm sorry, Mom. I can't find that here. When it's divine healing, it's healed in the natural way. It's not artificial gold filling your teeth, which, by the way, is not very good anyway. Okay, so, but we saw Marion Gothard, the brain tumor disappear. Saw that lady there, that tumor disappeared. I know God heals people. And so we've had a tremendous time. So we were in Puerto Rico. Brother Goff, we go to that jail. And I remember one time Marion Gothard and I went, and it was strange, Dale. It was a real weird service. Because we went into the jail service, and the guy opened the door, put us in there. And so we're waiting. We start singing. And then the men would come from the cells up to the dining area, which would hold 30, 40 people. And so we had a good group there, about 10 people. And there was a real invisible resistance. I don't know how to explain it. But sometimes when you're speaking, people are paying attention, and there's a give and take, a flow of communication, and you know you're actually communicating with them. But this day, this Monday, there was a barrier, like an invisible barrier there. I'm going, wow, was that? And so then I noticed, I put my chalk down, started preaching, five men left. And I preached a few more minutes, and 10 more left. And boy, I mean, we're losing our group here pretty quick, you know, and three or four more left. And I said, well, what I'm doing ain't no good. I said, Brother Gothard, I want you to come in here now and give us a testimony. And so I stopped right in the middle without finishing my sermon outline. Got that deal, didn't finish the sermon outline. Just stopped right in the middle. I said, Brother Gothard, come up here. The guy had been healed with a brain tumor. I said, come up here and give us a testimony. He, instead of giving a testimony, he started quoting verses in the Bible about the blood of Jesus Christ. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. And they washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. And he just started quoting those verses. And I noticed that the guard didn't like the Bible verses about the blood, so he left. And then a whole bunch of the prisoners came in, and we had about 30 people saved in that prison. And I asked him, I said, on the way home, I said, Brother Gothard, what do you think was going on there? I was trying to preach, wasn't doing any good. I had you come up there, give a testimony, but you didn't give a testimony. You just got up and started quoting those verses on the blood. He said, well, brother, he said, I was watching that thing. He said, I believe that guard was demon possessed. And so I just got up there and started quoting those verses on the blood, and he left. And then the people came in, and then there was no more barrier, and a bunch of people got saved. One time we went there to the prison in Puerto Rico, and the power was off. And so we had to break into the jail. And what we had to do, the doors were electric, so the guy had to come and turn the key, and then we had to shake the door open, and we had to shake it back closed, and then he locked it. And we had a wonderful time. We had a Bible study where the men could order, they could take four courses and get a diploma. And we had over 2,000 in about a year and a half there. I was the only Baptist chaplain. We had about 2,000 prisoners saved there in about a year and a half, 10 and 20 at a time in the prison. And so we, after Puerto Rico, we were home on furlough. Well, actually, while we were still in Puerto Rico, Brother Crane, Mike Crane, called me and said, Brother Haig, we're getting a group to go to Russia. I want you to pray about going with us and doing a chalk drawing in Red Square, Moscow. And so we went all the way over here to Russia, and he said, I want you to go with us. So we were able to raise the money, and we had a chance to go to Cuba, Russia, Red China, and Africa. And we just had a wonderful time. All right, now, while we were in Puerto Rico, they had a big island-wide conference, and they have, once a year, they have all the Baptists from all the English-speaking islands all come together to a different island, and they have a big Bible conference. Well, I was invited to speak at a Bible conference down on the island of Nevis and some other islands, and I met a lot of pastors from different islands, and so I started getting the invitation to go and to speak on all these islands. And so if you look on the photograph number four there on the storyboard, you'll see all those islands that go all the way down from Puerto Rico all the way to Central America. Now, the Dominican Republic and Cuba and Haiti and Puerto Rico are all Spanish-speaking islands, but then all the islands from Puerto Rico down are not Spanish. They are all English-speaking islands. And so I had a chance to preach in the Dominican Republic. I had a chance to preach in Cuba. And we're planning to go to Haiti next year. We have a new missionary that our church just started supporting just before the earthquake hit. And we'll be going down there and preaching for him. So let me just go down through and talk about some of the amazing things that happened. When we were coming back from Russia, Brother Crane said to me, he said, Brother Haig, he said, you speak Spanish, and the door to Cuba is now starting to open. He said, let's pray about going to Cuba. I said, okay. So we started praying about it, and we took a team to Cuba. And it was really an unusual situation because, first of all, the pastor was going to go to Washington, D.C. two or three days before, we were supposed to fly out of Miami to Cuba and get everybody's visa and everything so that we could go directly from Miami to Cuba. Well, it happened that it snowed in Washington, D.C., which in May, which it had never, in March, which it had never done before, and so in late March, and they closed the Cuban embassy. So they called him and said, brother, the Cuban embassy is closed for a week. We cannot get to the Cuban embassy to get these visas, and without the visa, the United States government would not allow you to fly directly from Cuba to, I mean, from Miami to Cuba. And so Brother Crane, I appreciate one thing about Brother Crane, is his attitude is, we're going one way or the other. And he told his travel agent, he said, I don't care if we have to go around it to the left, around it to the right, under it, over it, you get us to Cuba one way or the other. We can go there illegal, legal, whatever. We had all our paperwork done, and now we've got this big roadblock. We can't go. And so we flew through Nassau, Bahamas, and was able to go fly from Miami to Nassau, and then we were able to get a Cuban flight from Nassau into Cuba. It's really kind of interesting. We went on Cuban Airline, which was kind of a scary experience because the thing was terrible. It was an old twin prop job, and Brother Crane told the pilot that it was so bad we had the luggage was in the aisle. They didn't have enough room for our luggage. And so they put the luggage in the aisle, which is against law. And then he told the pilot, he said, you know, I'm studying to be a pilot. He says, let me try and fly. So they let him up there, who was not a licensed pilot, and he was up there. Crane was flying the airplane. Not a good idea. Okay. So we finally got there, was able to get all our stuff in there. And the second time, we took all this humanitarian aid. And the first time we went in, the second time we took a bunch of humanitarian aid, but the first time we went in there, we went around passing out tracts. Now, Brother Crane, we had set up, we divided into groups, and I was a group leader because I spoke Spanish, and so we had like two or three groups, and we would go to different churches and preach. We'd have like two or three different services each night in different churches, and it was a great opportunity, but what happened was, we asked the Cuban embassy, or the intersection in Washington, D.C., can we pass out this gospel literature? It has nothing to do with politics, not talking about the U.S. government, not talking about the embargo, not talking about anything going on. It just talks about what the Bible says about how to get to heaven. Can we pass this out? And they said, well, as long as the literature is not political, you can pass it out. Now, there's one thing you want to do. If you go to a communist country and you pass out literature, I would highly recommend not putting your name on it, okay? So what happened was Brother Crane had his personal testimony, had a picture of him breaking ice with a karate chop, you know, and so he put his name on it. And then Jamie Johnson, Randy Shepherd, they had a thing about them playing basketball and how they became Christians, and they put their name on it. So they're going all over Havana passing out tracts all over the place, and they got their name on it. Well, about 2 days later, all of a sudden, everybody was gone. Mike was gone doing something, getting something ready for services, and I got a knock on my door. And his wife, Naomi, next door said, Brother Haig, they have Jamie Johnson and Randy Shepherd downstairs interrogating them, and they keep calling up here and want to know where Mike Crane is. They want to talk to him. Would you please go down and find out what the problem is with the government? I said, okay. And so I told our youth director, Chris Atkinson, who's now pastoring up north. I said, Brother Atkinson, you come with me. If I go to jail, I want somebody to be able to tell my wife where I am, okay, that has a witness. So you come with me. So we went down there, and I said, excuse me. I said, my name is Dr. Haig. I said, I'm in one of the workers here, one of the leaders here in charge of this group. What seems to be the problem? And they said, well, this literature right here, you're not allowed to pass out this literature right here. I said, well, I'm sorry, sir. There's nothing political in there. And they told us, no, you foreigners can't pass out anything, you know. And so they were giving us orders. They said, you are under arrest. And we were under house arrest. We were not allowed to leave the hotel. Now, they did allow Mike and I to go to two or three churches that we had to go to and tell them that we would not be having services that night because we had a problem with the literature and they had put us under house arrest. And so The next morning, he and I went down to the government office. We had to go to the Religious Affairs Department because we were under arrest. And we had this permit to go down there and talk to the Religious Affairs Department. And so I told him, I said, look, we had taken 15 boxes of humanitarian aid. They were 15 boxes the size of a refrigerator that had toothpaste, aspirins, baby formula, toothbrushes, all kinds of humanitarian stuff to help the people there pass out in the churches. And it was something like, and some hospital equipment, bandages and stuff for the hospital. It was like $72,000 worth of stuff. And it's a miracle. It's a miracle we ever got that stuff out of there, because when we shipped the stuff down here, because we came in late, the government confiscated all of it. And so I went with a Cuban pastor, and we went and talked to him, said, look, this humanitarian aid for the people. And this one government official, God bless his heart, he said, listen, he said, I appreciate what you're doing. I'm going to go with you, and I'm going to help you get all this stuff out so you can give it out to help the Cuban people. And so he went in our car, and we went around and got all the signatures and all the stamps, legal stamps that we needed to get our 15 boxes of giant boxes out, filled up a whole truck, and 5 minutes before they closed that day, we were able to load all 15 refrigerator-sized boxes onto a truck and carry them down to the church and pass out all this humanitarian aid. And the pastor of the church there, Aposento Alto, the Upper Room Baptist Church, he said this. He said, you know, it's a miracle that you got this stuff out of that. Once the Cuban government confiscates something, you don't ever get it back. He said, that's a miracle you ever got that stuff back. And then we went to the Religious Affairs Department the following day, and after they put us under house arrest, and I said, listen, I said, Dr. Crane loves the Cuban people. He went all over America and got this humanitarian aid so he could pass it out. He paid to ship it down here. He's not asking for anything. He's just trying to help because he loves the Cuban people. And so finally, the Cuban government said this to me. They said, okay, you can go and give out your humanitarian aid, but you cannot celebrate Mass. And so I said, I promise, we will not celebrate Mass. But we did give an invitation, and we had over 500 people ask the Lord to save them. And the pastor of the Upper Room Baptist Church was just absolutely amazed. He said, I can't believe, one, that you were able to get this humanitarian aid. And he said, it's a miracle that they did not put you in jail and kick you out of the country permanently. And so we just praise the Lord for being able to go there. Brother Crane had probably raised over $500,000 building churches. He's probably built five large churches, much larger than this building. Probably, there's two or three of them, probably two or three times larger than this is a good-sized church here. This probably holds 300 or 400 or 500 people. And there were churches probably twice this size that we were able to work with. There's one church in particular that we were helping raise money and going down there preaching. We had hundreds of people come. One night alone, we had over 400 people come. And I'll never forget it. They had all the windows were out of it. The roof was taken off because the rafters were eaten up with termites, and so they had to put a whole new roof on. It was a gigantic building, and they had a 40-foot long I-beam. Like, it go like from here back there to that wall, probably a little further. And there was this giant beam about this tall, about that wide, and it was sitting right in the middle of the church, and they had to get it up on the top, you know. And so they were just praying. Castro owns all the equipment. You cannot rent, you cannot buy, you cannot borrow. He owns all the cranes, all the bulldozers, all the equipment. Nobody can do anything unless they got to go through him. So they were praying, how are they going to get this steel beam up there so they can put the roof back on? And we had that church packed every night with that steel beam sitting right down the middle of the building. And so they prayed and prayed, and after we had left, I checked and I said, how'd they ever get that beam up there? He said, you won't believe what happened. He said they were praying about it, and one of Castro's cranes, he had a, you know, on a truck frame, had a big crane, was driving down the street right in front of church, and wham, the motor on the truck broke down. Now, the crane was working fine, but the truck motor wouldn't run, and it was on Friday, so they couldn't do anything. It was over the weekend, so I said, well, we won't worry about it till Monday. And so they're sitting there with their crane, and so the pastor said, hey, how would you like to make a little extra money? I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you just crank up your crane, put the boom over here, pick that beam, and they already had the places set for the beam to set on, and set that beam up on there. Said, well, I don't know, I'd probably give them $500. And they were able to get that giant steel beam miraculously put up there and able to put the roof on, and now they're having services in that church. And it's just a miracle to see the things that have been done in spite of the hindrances, the opposition from the government. They've let us do a lot, amazingly. One good thing about the communists, they won't let the Jehovah's Witnesses in there, and they won't let the Mormons in there. And so we've got a free hand, and we've had a wonderful, wonderful time. So then we went from Cuba. We've gone in and out of Cuba for the last probably 8 years, had over 6,000 people saved, been able to build about 5 churches, and some of them just from scratch, and raised probably close to almost $500,000 to help the people in Cuba. One of the things that we would do when we go to an area, we'd always, in our group, we'd divide up into groups, and I'd be a group leader, then Mike'd have another group, and then sometimes we'd have three groups. We'd always take up an offering and try and give a special offering just to the pastor. We tried to give each Cuban pastor $100 because they only make like $20, $30 a month. And so we tried to give him $100 just for his family to buy food for their family. And you need to pray for him. We had one man there. His name was Eliezer Prieto. And we went down there to take $25,000 to help build one of the churches. And when we did, just as we were getting ready to leave, this man came up and said, Brother Hague, I understand that you had prostate cancer and you went to a special clinic in Atlanta and have been cured. He said, do you think there's a chance that I could get into that clinic? He said, I'm pretty certain I have prostate cancer. My brother lives in Miami. He's been operated on for prostate cancer. Do you think you could get him in? And I said, well, I'll see, you know. And I had sent a lot of people to the clinic. At that time, I probably only sent about 50 or 60 people, and I was hoping to send a lot more so that they would feel obligated, because I probably sent close to 300 people to that clinic, and the treatment's now about $90,000, so that's close to probably about $20 million I've sent patient referral up there. So I called him, and I said, look, I said, I have a friend in Puerto Rico. He's a pastor. When he was in Bible college, one of the first things that happened was Castro went around and arrested all the Bible college students and put them on his slave labor coffee plantations to work for free. Got them all. This young man, Eliezer Prieto, had only been married about 6 months, and all of a sudden the Castro's communist goons came in there and they arrested all of them. Put them in this prison work farm, and he said, at first we thought, well, this is just temporary, but he's going to, you know, he'll let us out in a few months after he has, you know, complete control of the country. And so 6 months went by, they didn't get out. A year went by, they didn't get out. A year and a half went by, they didn't get out. 2 years, they're still in Castro's prison working on his coffee plantations for free. And so finally, they said, there are probably 100 of these Bible college students. They said, you know what? We're going to live and die. His wife didn't even know where he was. He said, we're going to live and die right here working for Castro on his coffee plantations. And one news reporter had heard about this, and so he pretended, this is really funny how the God got him out of it. He pretended to be a communist newspaper reporter and flew to Cuba from another country and said, I'm working for the communist newspaper over there. I'd like to do a report. And he went around and videotaped these Bible college people in prison working for Castro. And so when Castro showed up at the United Nations meeting in New York City, the United States ambassador showed this video showing these Bible college students in jail working for free, and the political pressure was so great that Castro had to let him out. Amen, brother. So God got him out of there. So this guy had been in jail for 2.5 years because he was saved, serving Castro, working for Castro on his coffee plantation. And so he said this. He said, Brother Hague, you know, I was in jail for 2.5 years, and for Castro, and now I think I've got prostate cancer. Do you think there's any way I can get into that clinic? So I went to Dr. Kreitz, who set up the radiotherapy clinics of Georgia, and I'll talk about that later, about how God got me through there. And I said, look, I've got this pastor down here in Cuba, and his brother had prostate cancer. His father died of prostate cancer, and he's certain that he has prostate cancer. He's about 65 years old. Is there any way that we can work something out where we can get him in here? And they said this. They said, well, we appreciate all the patient referrals that you've done, sent a lot of people up there. He said, I'll tell you what we're going to do. If you can get your cash, you can get your Cuban friend here who only makes $20 a month, we will do the entire treatment for free for him. Now, it cost me $30,000 10 years ago. Now it's $90,000 for this treatment. And so I called him. I said, okay. They said, if there's some way we can get you here. And the amazing thing is he already had a visa to come to New Jersey to preach in a Spanish-speaking church up there. Not only did he already had a visa, he already had a permit from the Cuban government to get out of there, and he already had an airplane ticket. They were flying him up there. 2 weeks later, he was in the cancer clinic in Atlanta, and they were doing the radiation treatment. They do four types of radiation simultaneously. His wife was able to come and stay with him. They have a free hotel called the Winn-Dixie Hope Lodge, $15 million hotel, and he was able to stay in the $15 million hotel for free. He got the $30,000 radiation treatment, cured of prostate cancer, and stayed in a $15 million hotel for 7 weeks for free. I think 6 or 7 weeks. And so he was so moved when he left. Here he said in Cuba, if you have cancer in Cuba, what they do is they say, okay, you've got cancer, take these two aspirins and you'll be okay. And when you have cancer in Cuba, it is a death sentence. They just send you home to die. And so he was so moved that these Americans, who did not even know him, that they put him in this cancer treatment for free, put him in a $15 million hotel for free. He was so moved that he just broke down in tears and thanked the people at the Winn-Dixie Hope Lodge for letting him stay there for 6 weeks for free. And we've had a tremendous ministry in Cuba. We will be going back to Cuba in April, and we're going to hope that we do not get arrested. I'm going to be very careful about that. So you pray for us as we go to Cuba. After Cuba, we went on over. Then we preached in the Dominican Republic. We flew over from Puerto Rico four times to the Dominican Republic. Had probably 100 people, over 100 people saved in the Dominican Republic. Then we started going down through the islands. We started going down through the islands to St. Thomas, went over and preached in St. Thomas twice. They wanted me to come over there and teach in the Bible college over there, and had a lot of people say, oh, I did a stained glass window about this size, but instead of a painting on the wall, I took this plastic that they use that you make an artificial stained glass window and dabbed it on the window and did like a 20-foot window of a Bible picture at only stained glass window I did in St. Thomas. Then we went down to the island of Nevis. And on Nevis, the island of Nevis was a small island. The pastor there named Brother Williams. His son had been drowned, and he asked me at this big island-wide conference, would I come and preach in his island? Now, what I usually do is I usually have a small painting about like this, but only about this size with a nice frame, and I always give away a painting when I'm preaching in a place for a week. Now, Dale, if they only have me preach one day, I don't give away a painting. If I'm there for a week. I think I gave away a painting here, didn't I? Yeah, I gave away a painting here. Whoever brings the most visitors. Well, on the island of Nevis, which is just down from Puerto Rico, I had the greatest response to the painting I've ever had. And that was the church was probably the size of the center here only, maybe smaller than that. And it probably hold 100 people. And they usually ran about 50 people on Sunday. That week, we had 950 visitors that week. And I don't mean evangelistically speaking. I mean we were writing them down. Okay, we're counting them, writing them down. He had 50, he had 20, he had 30, he had 40. And there were the guy who won the painting, he and his family brought 450 visitors. They had over 50 people come down the aisle and get saved. And that week they doubled their membership in 1 week. And there was one guy that had one leg, And he hopped around with a crutch, you know, he was hopping around with one leg and a crutch. And it was very hilly, very mountainous, kind of like this here, very hilly, very mountainous. And that guy brought 76 visitors with one leg and no car and no telephone. And then the couple, the family that won, it was the husband, his wife, and his brother and their wife and his sister and their wife. The three families worked together. They brought 400, brought people that actually came and, you know, not contacts, but they actually came, brought 450 visitors and won the painting. I told the pastor, I would have made him assistant pastor in charge of visitation right there on the spot. You bring 450 visitors in 1 week. You know, sometimes we'd have as many people outside looking in the windows and the doors as we had inside. And it was just a great time. It was real inspiration, the greatest response I ever had to give the painting. Then we went on to the island of Montserrat. I was just telling Brother Dale, so we went to the island of Montserrat with Brother Neuro Gums, a great carpenter. He built a $250,000 house right on the side of this volcano. Montserrat is a very small island that's actually the residue of one volcano. And we preached there, and the only piece of plywood he had was a 4-foot by 8-foot wolvenite soaked in that green cure stuff. It probably weighed 400 pounds. I mean, it was the heaviest thing I ever picked up. It's probably twice as heavy as this board up here, and that's heavy. That thing probably weighs 100 pounds. And so it was very, very, I'm sure it weighed 300 pounds. It took two men, and they had a hard time getting it up on the easel. But anyway, so we preached on that island, had a lot of people saved. And when you land, get this, Dale, when you land on the island of Montserrat in a little tiny plane, there's a big sign, and it says, "Welcome to Montserrat, the home of beautiful women and mountain chicken." I asked the pastor, I said, "Well, I know what beautiful women is, I think, but what is the mountain chicken there?" He said, "Well, that's frog legs." That's what, when we say mountain chicken, we're talking about frog legs. And I ate goat meat, frog legs, all kinds of unusual things there. But after I'd preached on that island, I was back in Florida, and I was sitting there watching the History Channel, and the volcano, several years later, the volcano in Montserrat exploded and completely destroyed the entire island. They had to move everybody off. And I'm sitting there watching this movie, and I'm going, well, I stayed in the guy's house right there, and I preached right over there. And I mean, it's volcanic ash and lava coming down, and I mean, they had like, you know, had about 6 inches or a foot of volcanic ash. I mean, it was really, really dangerous. It's an English island, and the country of England had to move all the people off the island. The guy lost his $250,000 house. And I said, well, one thing, somebody was there preaching the truth, preaching the gospel. They had a chance to hear the gospel no matter what else happened. And I'm going, man, a volcano exploded. I told Dan, we need to make a movie of this, man. Go in there and preach, and then a volcano explodes, and the whole thing goes to pot. And then we went down to the island of St. Martin, and St. Martin was half of us French, and half of it was, English. I think half of us English, half of us French, run by the French government, the English government. And it's really funny. They started walking around the island and said, okay, that part's mine, this part's yours. And had a chance to preach at a Haitian church there, and had a wonderful time preaching there. And that's where Dick Morris died. He would go with us and sing. They were a great help to us. Went all through those islands. And he was there one time after we'd been there and preached, had a lot of people saved. And he went back there with Ronnie Harrison, Dr. Ronnie Harrison up here in Galax. And they went back and was going to have a meeting. And he said they were getting ready. They preached Sunday night, and Monday morning, they're getting ready to go to jail, I believe it was, and he said they were sitting there in the church waiting, and they saw some goats, and he said, oh, get those goats out of there. They don't need to have no goats in there. So the church is for sheep, not goats. And so he ran the goats out, and Dick sat down right there, and God called him home. He said, I want to die with my boots on, serving Jesus. He was getting ready. They just preached, just sang, and getting ready to go preach in jail, and God called him home right there from the island of St. Martin. Then we went down to the island of Aruba, preaching in that conference. Brother Hostetler, missionary in Aruba, said, I want you to come down here to Aruba. I said, okay. So we got ready, packed up everything, flew down to the island of Aruba. When I got there, I was walking down the street, and he said, you see this right here? I said, yeah. He said, well, we had a Rastafarian. Now, they had a Rastafarian. I don't know if you're familiar with what a Rasta man is. The Rastafarians are a black racist cult. And they hate white people. And they said, okay, if a white man lives in a house, we're not going to live in a house. We're going to sleep out on the beach. If a white man cuts his hair short, we're not going to have short hair. We're going to let our hair grow long into the dreadlocks. They hate God, hate the Bible, hate white people. Okay, so he said, Brother Haig, we had a terrible thing happen here in Aruba. I said, is that right? He said, yes, and this would make a great movie. Okay, said, yes, this Rastafarian guy, big, strong guy, 26 years old, lifting weights on the beach, looked like the picture of health. While he was out there sleeping on the beach, hating God and the Bible and everybody else, all of a sudden he got a terrible headache. And so he finally, it's so bad, he had to go to the doctor. And he went to the doctor and said, doctor said, man, I got this headache. And he said, well, let me cut your hair. Oh, no, can't touch my hair, sacred cow. And he said, okay, well, cut your hair then. He said, I'll tell you what, said, take these pain pills and I'll see you tomorrow. So the guy walked out of the doctor's office. Sun was shining brightly, 12 o'clock noon, walked out of the doctor's office, walked about 20 feet, and wham, fell dead right in the street. And so the law is in Aruba, if somebody appears to be healthy and they just all of a sudden die, you got to have an autopsy. And so they did an autopsy, and here's what they found, Dale, while he was out there sleeping under the trees. About 20 of these centipedes, these hundred-legged worms, crawled up in his super afro hairdo and made a nest. And a centipede has a real small mouth like a maggot. I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but you could put a maggot on your hand and the maggot could eat right through your hand and come out on the other side and you wouldn't even feel the maggot bite you. You know, because he had a little tiny mouth. And so he had these centipedes, about a dozen of them up here in his head, and they started eating right down through his skull. They ate through the skin. They ate through the skull bones and ate right into his brains and ate him alive. Now, that would make an interesting movie. The centipedes eating through his skull, man. And I'm going, what? What did he die of? Well, the Bible says specifically, doth not nature itself teach that if a man have long hair, it's a shame unto him? The Bible says if you're a man, don't have long hair. And this guy said, I don't care what the Bible says. Well, let me tell you something. You know, the stuff that you don't think that is important in the Bible can get you killed. You know what he died of? Long hair. That's what he died of. You better watch out, not mess around. These teenagers that think, I don't care what the Bible says. You better take care of what the Bible says. Some of that stuff that you don't think is important can get you killed, man. Do you know that I just saw Paul Harvey said there were 200 teenagers last year that are going to die from AIDS because when they went down to get their ear pierced or their nose pierced or their jaw pierced or their chin pierced, that they picked up AIDS. Okay, and so the things that you don't think, the body piercing and the tattoos and the long hair stuff, some of that stuff you don't think that's important can get you killed. And so the guy died there in the island of Aruba. We had a great opportunity helping Brother Hostetler down there. I'm going to try to get back there to preach for the pastor that's there now, Brother Hostetler. The Lord called him home here a couple years ago. He's now in heaven, but the church and the work is still going on there in Aruba. All right, now we're going to continue with the fourth missionary trip or the fourth missionary area. This is actually the fifth, I think, isn't it? The fifth missionary area. We did Honduras, Costa Rica, where we studied language school. Went to Guatemala, was in Puerto Rico, went to the islands all the way down, went to Cuba. And while we were in Puerto Rico, Brother Crane called me and said, we want you to go with us to Russia. And so we went to Russia. Then after that, we went to Cuba. And so we went to Russia one year, and I left my church in Puerto Rico in charge of the people who were the church we'd been there, been going for about 2 or 3 years now. We'd been in Puerto Rico about 10 years. And the church was really stable. We had a Christian school running about 100. The Christian school in Puerto Rico is now running about 250. How many of you have in your Christian school here? Close to 100, okay. Well, we're running about 250 now in Puerto Rico, and the other Christian school, they're running about 700. We have 15 Christian schools in Puerto Rico, and we did a Christian school Olympic Games the last year we was there, and it was exciting. My daughter won one of the first gold medals in a relay race, and it was really, really exciting. Aren't you doing the Christian Olympic here, Dale? What, Friday? I'm looking forward to that. I'm going to come to that, brother. I'm looking forward to that. And so while we were there, Brother Crane called me and said, listen, Brother Haig, I'm getting a group to go to Russia, and I want you to come, and I want you to do some chalk drawings. Now, here we have a chart about our internet thing, but underneath here has some of the chalk drawings. So we do, every night, I do chalk drawings. Now, here's a chalk drawing we did last night dealing with the World War III, IV, and V, about the devil, the dragon, and the Battle of Armageddon. We dealt with that. And then the Bible says, I saw a new heaven and new earth. So I do chalk drawing. I originally started off drawing on white paper. And on this video, we're going to show our trip to Russia. We have it on the internet. If you go to YouTube and you look under Bill Haig, you can scroll down. We have over 1,000 videos there. And if you look under Bill Haig, you'll come to Bill Haig in Red Square, Moscow. If you want to see the other videos, you go to Dr. Haig, and you'll have all the video clips from Mexico and from Red China, and I mean from Africa, Mexico, and those are under Dr. Haig, okay? But that's what we do. Now, this here is I use a permanent color background, and I draw on this and write Bible verses on it. And so we went. He said, I want you to do a chalk drawing like that in Red Square, Moscow. So we prayed about it. The Lord sent in the money, and we were able to go to Russia. I won't pull this back down because I want to cover the internet ministry that we're now involved in. And so while we were there, we went to, here we go, Red Square, Moscow. We went down to the town of Kyiv in the Ukraine and worked with some wonderful people there. We worked with local churches. And the local churches there, they just have a bunch of wonderful Baptist preachers, and we just had a tremendous time. We would go to the public schools in the morning, and we go to two or three public schools in the morning, and then we would preach on the street, and we have some photos there. Aren't there photos right there? I think it's down there on number, let me see what number those photos are on. The Russia is down there on number. Didn't have them preaching there on the street. Yeah, it's the Russian one. This Russian number is on the photo there. Number 7. Number 7 has preaching on the street. So we'll scan those in there. And the greatest place to preach. Now, I preached on the street here in Mount Airy. I preached in Pensacola. I preached all over the country on the street. We preached on the street in Honduras, Costa Rica. When we were there in language school, I go down and do chalk drawings in the public park. And it was just a great, great opportunity. But the greatest place and the best response we've ever had to open-air evangelism is in the city of Kyiv. And they have a sidewalk, Brother Dale. The sidewalk in the main drag there, the sidewalk, okay, here's the road. But the sidewalk is this wide, runs from here to where you are. It's about 40 feet, okay? That's the sidewalk on both sides of the street. And a lot of people don't have cars, so they walk. And you'll have hundreds of people walking on the sidewalk. And you can stand up there, and you'll see on the video, we're just standing there, and we'll sing Amazing Grace in English in a country that speaks Russian. And if you speak you're singing in English, you'd have 50 or 100 people stop. And we'd give an invitation. Dick and Shirley would help us. They went with us about 4 or 5 times up there. And Brother Gothard and his wife went 4 or 5 times from Alaska. And we give an invitation, and 10 people would come. I mean, people with suits and ties, upper middle class people would come and pray right there on the street and ask them to get saved. 1 year, we had over 2,000 people in 10 days. We had about 200 people a day. 10 and 20 at a time would come forward, and then we'd have like 200 people a day for 10 days straight in the morning would respond to the invitation and ask Jesus to save them. We had over 2,000 people saved preaching on the street. Now, if you ever done any street preaching, that is pretty good, brother. A lot of times in America, you get up and pass out tracts that they don't even stop. They don't even listen, you know. Now, they got to stop for the red light, and then you get a few minutes there. But it's just the greatest place to preach on the street. And then we went to the churches. We go to the street in the morning. Then we do the schools in the morning. Then we do the open air thing in the afternoon down in the park because there'd be people there. And then we would go and have services in churches at night. And so the reason we had so many people saved, it was like putting out a trout line. A trout line is you string a line out in the river and you put a bunch of different hooks on it. And nobody goes to this one, no fish gets on this one, but maybe get one on that one. And so we were doing like Christian trout line fishing. We went to the school, we go to 5 and 10 schools in the morning, we would go to the open air programs in the afternoon, and then we would have services at night. And when the first year, I think we had something like 17,000 people who responded to the invitation, 2,000 on the street, a bunch in the schools, and a bunch of people. We had 12,000 people each night, and you can see that on the video. If you go to YouTube and go to Bill Haag, B-I-L-L-H-A-A-G, and you go scroll down, you'll say Red Square Moscow, and you'll see we had 12,000 people who came out each night to the big sports arena. And then after we got done in the city of Kyiv, we went up to the town, we went up to Moscow, to Red Square Moscow, and I'll never forget it. It was the greatest opportunity I've ever had. And I went there, and I had my chalk drawing rolled up like this, a piece of paper. These are on cloth, but I had some of them that were on paper. And so I had my chalk drawing rolled up like this in a piece of paper, so I'm carrying this roll around like this, rolled up. And Dr. Henry Bennett said to me, he says, now, Brother Haag, he said, take your chalk drawing and go over there and do a chalk talk. Okay, now we were standing with one group preaching, and he said, everybody's not going to get an opportunity to give a testimony or anything, so take this group, take half of the people, and go over there and do a chalk drawing. It's probably, oh, good night, it's probably from here to the mission house across the street there, you know, probably 50 yards or something. And so I said, okay, and I said, but Henry, we only have one interpreter, and that interpreter's here. I don't have an interpreter. He said, oh, don't worry about it, Brother Haag. He said, God will supply you an interpreter. And I said, well, Henry, I got my paper rolled up here, but I need a piece of plywood. I need something to stick the paper on, okay? Oh, he said, don't worry about it. He said, the Lord will provide. And I'm going, this is crazy. Here I am. I got 10 people following me. I need a person who speaks fluent English and Russian in 5 minutes, and I need a 4x8 sheet of plywood in Red Square, Moscow, and I need it in 5 minutes, okay? And I'm going, this is crazy. I don't know what I'm going to do. You know, and then all the people who follow me, Dale, they think I know what I'm doing, okay? And I'm going, oh, man, this is awful. And so I walked over to the corner there, and what had happened was it was right in front of Lenin's tomb, okay? Here was Lenin's tomb right over here, and we're right across the street in front of Lenin's tomb, and it was a department store, and somebody had broken the window of this big glass window of the department store, and they put a piece of plywood up right at this height, and just like this, they had a piece of plywood fastened with bolts to the front of the store at the right height, and I'm going, man, that's amazing. There's a piece of plywood stuck right on the front of it. So I took my drawing and I started unrolling this drawing, you know, to put the thing on there and put it on there with some tape or some tacks. And while I was doing this, there were two college-age girls that came up and said, oh, are you people from America? And I said, yeah, we're. I said, man, you speak really good English. Oh, yes, yeah, we've studied English for 10 years, you know, in school, all through high school and through college and everything. I said, how would you like to earn $5? I said, if you'll stand here and translate for us, I'll give each of you $5 if you'll stand here and translate. They said, yeah. Now, five, you got to remember now, $5 is like a week's wages. Okay, they only make about $20 a month, okay, in Russia. It's terrible. And so said, yeah, they'll make a week's wages standing here for us. So we're standing here, and I'm drawing. And you can see it on the video. I'm drawing and preaching. And they're standing there, they're standing there translating for us. Then we have somebody come up and sing, and then they translate the song, and somebody come up and give a testimony, and then I get up and preach some more. And we had 250 people saved in Red Square, Moscow. Now, we did have a little problem, Dale. Right in the middle of the preaching, these two girls, they would take turns. You know, one get tired, and then the other one start translating. Right in the middle, they started to light up a cigarette. I said, whoa. You can't smoke no cigarette while you're translating the Bible here, okay? And so we had a tremendous time. I consider that one of the greatest opportunities. If I have a chance to preach, I'm not interested in preaching the First Baptist Church of Fort Worth or anyplace else. I'd rather preach in Red Square, Moscow. Amen. And then we got on a night train and went up to Moscow the second time. And it's kind of funny. We went to the McDonald's. The biggest McDonald's in the world at that time was in Moscow. They have 8,000 people that go to McDonald's in Moscow every day. 8,000 customers. And they have a line. People go to McDonald's with a suit and tie, brother. They don't go in no blue jeans and a t-shirt, okay? They go in a suit and tie. And the funny thing is, it's really considered upper class to be able to go to McDonald's to eat. There, we had one guy that was a Merrill Lynch investing counselor, investment man, like a stockbroker guy. And he said, I never eat at McDonald's in America. He said, but in Russia, we would have we'd have cabbage soup, which they call borscht, and black bread almost every day with caviar. And so it's kind of funny because Americans don't like caviar. So there'd be 15 of us sitting in a restaurant. So we take all our caviar and scoop it into one bowl and give it to the bus driver. And boy, he thought he had made it. He's eating the whole bowl of caviar, probably worth $20-$30. And so he said, I'm tired of this cabbage soup and black beans. Give me a Big Mac. And so we had a McDonald's now we did have a big problem. So after the second year when we went up to Moscow to preach, we went up on a night train. The first time we flew, but the second year we went up on a night train, and then we got off and we were going to fly back from Moscow to the United States. Well, we had our tickets, which was, I don't know, thousands of dollars. We had like 20-30 people. And one thing that happened while we were in Red Square preaching there is Mike was going to take one group and they're going to go to this giant 2-mile-long flea market in Moscow after the street meeting. And so he left. And I said, no, I'm going to stay here. I told him, I am not leaving Red Square until I have somebody saved. I don't care if I spend all night here. And so we went up, set up the drawing, and we had about 50 people saved the first time. We had a bunch, but they'd already left at the bus. And so there was one of the teachers from Tennessee Temple, Dr. Hass. I think, did you know a Dr. Hass there? Okay, anyway, it was one of the retired professors from Tennessee Temple back 40 years ago. And he got separated from the group. And so finally we got down to our street meeting down on the corner, and I saw him. He was wandering around. Here's this American going, you could tell he didn't know where. I said, Brother Hass, did you miss the bus? He said, did they leave? I said, Brother, they're gone. And I said, listen, you come with me, brother. I don't want you getting lost. And so we had to take the freeway, the subway. We went down to the subway. The subway was also a bomb shelter, atomic nuclear bomb shelter. Is really deep, brother. I mean, I don't know how many hundred feet it was, but I mean, you went down, 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 down. And you were going fast, too, on the escalator. And we went down and got on there, and I'm going, oh, man, now how are we going to know to get off? They had a mile-long flea market called on Arbot Street, Arbot. And I said, excuse me, ma'am. I said, could you tell me how to get, we got to go to Arbot Street. She said, okay, look, I will take you on the subway. The best way to go is just go on the subway, and I'll show you where to get off. And, boy, I mean, that Russian, I studied Russian for a year at the University of Puerto Rico. And we learned to sing a song. I'll sing a song for you in Russian. It goes like this. Всё хорошо в доме Бога. And so everything's all right in my Father's house. It goes like this. Todo está bien. Oh, that's Spanish. Всё хорошо в доме Бога. В доме Бога. В доме Бога. Всё хорошо в доме Бога. Радиус, радиус, радиус. That's everything's all right in my Father's house. There'll be joy, joy, joy. So this lady got on the subway with about 10 of us, including Brother Hass, who got lost, got separated. And we got on the subway and she said, okay, this is where you get off. And said, our broad street's right down there. And I really appreciate that lady taking it, going way out of her way to get us to where we needed to go. And so we praise the Lord. We've been in and out of Russia about six times. We've had over the first year we had 17,000 people on the street, in the school, in the churches, in the big sports arena. We had 17,000 people pray and ask the Lord to save them. The next year we had 12,000 people, and during the 6 years I figured it up as something like 30 or 40,000 people that we've had saved. We met some wonderful Christian people. And it's very interesting in Russia that it's not what you think. In Russia, the average person on the street is pro-American, pro-Bible, pro-Christian, pro-church. They are for the Bible. They're for the church. They respect the Bible. There are only 10% of the people in Russia are card-carrying communists. It's 10% of the people are running the other 90%, and why they don't throw them out is a mystery to me. And so same thing in Cuba. Castro and his goons are anti-God, anti-Bible, everything else. But the average Cuban on the street is pro-American, pro-God, pro-Bible, pro-church. And we just had a wonderful time in Russia. Then we went on to China. And on the way back, this one group said, we need to, want you to go with me to help me get a visa in China. So Mike and I went with, I'm trying to think what his name is, missionary in China. Oh, it's not Williams. I'll think of it in a minute. But anyway, we were going there to help him, and I took some medical equipment, and we went to Red China. But on the way to Red China, Brother Mucher said, now, Brother Haig, what we're going to do on the way to Red China, we're going to stop in Thailand for a week or 10 days, and we're going to go to these leper colonies, and we're going to make a video to try to raise money for the leper children. You see, leprosy is a very unusual disease. If the children cannot get leprosy until they reach the age of puberty, until they reach about 10, 12 years old. They cannot contract leprosy, even though their parents have that. And that's what they had. They had a bunch of parents. They had children, and their children did not have leprosy. But if those children stay in that home as they become teenagers, they will get leprosy. So what you have to do is you have to have an orphanage where you can put these children. The people in Thailand will not adopt these children because they're afraid that they'll bring leprosy into their house and their kids will get leprosy, and you know they're just not going to do that. So this missionary was working there. Tommy Tillman worked there with these lepers, and so we were there making videos. So he told me, he said, and by the way, on the way to Red China, we're going to stop in Thailand, and you're going to preach in these three or five leper colonies. And I said, leprosy? I said, it's kind of funny because I just met thinking to myself, I'm not afraid of these communists. Castro put me in jail. I said, I'm not afraid of any of this stuff. And then this guy says, you're going to preach to these lepers. I said, Lord, I'm afraid of getting leprosy. I don't want to get leprosy, okay? So I read up on leprosy. Leprosy is a first cousin to tuberculosis. We preached in Africa, and one of the ladies in the church, Dale, one of the ladies in the church in the town of Krobo, had leprosy. There was a person in the church I preached in had leprosy. And so I preached in these leper colonies, and they said, leprosy is like tuberculosis. If somebody spits on the ground that has leprosy, don't step in it. If they sneeze, their body fluids, spit, sneezing, any body fluids can give you leprosy. And so I went and preached in those five leper colonies. I said, man, this is terrible. I am afraid of leprosy, okay? I'll just tell you flat out, I am afraid of leprosy. I do not want to get leprosy. And so we went there, and the last day there in the leper colony, they had dinner on the grounds where the lepers prepared food, and then you sit with them and eat with them. And the hardest thing I've ever had to do is sit down and eat food with people that had leprosy and worried about getting leprosy. And thank God I did not. Now, what I did do is I threw all my clothes away. I threw my shoes away. I took an extra pair of shoes. I got rid of all. I didn't want to carry any leprosy germs. But we had 68 lepers trust God, ask the Lord to save him in those different leper colonies, doing chalk drawings and object lessons. There's one man, whenever you think that you're having a hard time, I'll tell you how to get over feeling bad about your particular situation. There's one man there, pastor, had leprosy, and all his fingers were gone. Okay, he had no fingers, they were gone. He had no toes, okay. All he had for transportation was a bicycle, and he pastored five different churches in five different towns, and he would have to get on there with those nubs and try and hold the handlebars to the bicycle, and without any toes, try to pedal, and he would go a little bit, hit a bump, and there aren't paved roads, they're dirt roads, chuck holes, potholes, and he'd hit a roll, fall over, get up, get on there, right a bit, fall over, get up, right a bit, and he goes out there 2 or 3 miles and goes to that church and preaches, go to that church and preaches, and I said, you know what, God help me if I ever complain about anything. I'm riding around in a car. It ain't a brand new car. It ain't the greatest fan in the world. But you know what? I got fingers. I got toes. I'm not falling down in the dirt, getting up, falling down, getting in the dirt. And you know what? And those one thing about those lepers that were saved is they had the most cheerful attitude and just so thankful for stuff that Tommy Tillman had done there in helping their houses, getting them up out of the mud and stuff, building little bridges, keeping out of the dirt, the mud, the garbage there in the street. And we were able to raise about $30,000 and help build that. One of our churches sent $30,000 in to help build that orphanage. They now have an orphanage where they take those kids out of the leper homes and they put them in there so they will not contract leprosy. And so on the way to China, we went in there. China helped, I can't think of the guy's name, he's over in Birmingham. And we now have an all-Chinese TV station. We'll talk about that in a minute. So then we went into China, did some preaching in some underground churches, and I put chalk talk on a wall and did some chalk drawings. I have three chalk drawings I do in Chinese characters. Chinese, by the way, we have an all-Chinese TV station. If you go to our website, it'll tell you where our all-Chinese TV station. When I go to a Chinese restaurant, I always show them where our Chinese TV station is. It has the Gospel of Luke, and it all has The Light of the World by Chick Publication Chinese. And I went to a Chinese restaurant in Pensacola, Florida, and there was a young man there who got saved in a church in Texas. And I said, look, I need somebody to come translate for me. We have a TV studio in our home that I set up, and we'll do a live broadcast in Chinese and record. So he came to our house, and I did five chalk drawings in Chinese, in the Chinese language. We've also done in the Korean language. Went to the Korean pastor and did it in the Korean language. So we have all Chinese TV station, and I have chalk drawings I've done in the Chinese language. Well, while we were there in China, we did the thing. Now, China is very dangerous. They will shoot you in China for passing out tracts. I'm telling the communist government in China. One Christian man went over there in China, and he was just going over for his business and thought he'd pass out a few tracts while he was there. And they sent his body home in a box and said he committed suicide. His wife said he did not commit suicide. He was not depressed. There are no family problems. He was excited about going there and passing out tracts. I said, those people killed him over there. He did not commit suicide. And so China was very, very, very dangerous. Now, one thing that I did do in China, which was very interesting, is we went from Hong Kong. We got down in Hong Kong, and we went out to go over in Hong Kong to get on the train to go up to Zhengzhou in China. And when we did, it was a terrible when we went to the train station because they had like a Walmart parking lot. Okay, here's this giant parking lot. And that parking lot was full of people sitting with their suitcases. There's no roof. I mean, they're in the open, okay? And here's all these probably 1,000, 2,000 people sitting in this Walmart parking lot. And I asked the interpreter, I said, hey, What are all those people there? He said, all those people are waiting to get on the train. I'm going, they're waiting to get on the train? Well, you mean we got to wait in the line? He said, no, because you're an American, you get to go to the front of the line. I said, thank God for that, man. 2,000 people with their suitcase sitting on the parking lot waiting to get on the train. So we were able to get on the train. And I personally, I wish they had a train going across the ocean. I'd never get on an airplane. I'd go by train everywhere. I like the train. You go back there, read your Bible, take a nap, get up, go down to the dining car, get some hot tea and toast and stuff. Read. It's the most enjoyable way I've ever traveled. Now, you forget the car, forget the airplane. Give me the train, brother. So we went all the way on the night train, went up, and so we were down in the dining car. And we're going up to Jungjo to help this missionary get a visa. And while we're in the dining car, the only people allowed to eat in the dining car were foreigners, business people, and politicians, political people. No Chinese were allowed in the thing. The Chinese people, now we had a private sleeping car where we could take a nap, a little cot in there. But the other people, they had them stacked five high. The other trains in China is one, two, they had four high. It's four high. They had four beds, one, two, three, four. And they had people, so they're open. There's no privacy at all, you know. They're just laying down in there. And so from our sleeping car to the dining car was seven cars. And so we'd have to go through the seven cars to get to the dining car. It'd take, you know, 5-10 minutes. And so we got up there and got something. And this mission, there, we were in there eating, and there were the folks from Canada. And they said, well, what are you Americans doing here? You're not allowed in Red China. No. My passport had stamps in it, Russia, Red China, Cuba. I came through the immigration thing coming to the United States one time, and that immigration lady said, Russia, Red China, Cuba. She said, what are you, a double agent or something? All these communist countries. And so I said, no, I'm with the Baptist Church. We're going to preach it. And so so when we were sitting there, I said, no, we were in Thailand making this video for the leper children. I was telling them what we were doing. And I said, I do chalk art. I do these drawings and preach. And then I do gospel magic, you know. Like this, see, and so I think I might have had something with me. I had this one right here. I said, like this right here. See, you have three ropes. That represents a president. That represents your boss at work. And the short one represents you. Now watch. Nothing in this hand. Nothing in that hand. Now when you look at that, the president, your boss at work, the rest of us, we say they're all different. The Bible says man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. And God looks them over very carefully on the inside. The imagination, the thoughts of their heart. And you know what he said? He said, you know what the fact is? The fact is they're not really different. They're really all the same. You see, they're all the same length right there, all right? The president has to get saved just like you and I, of course. But the problem is when you and I look at them, they're all different. But God says everybody's the same. Everybody needs to get saved. So they said, oh, you do magic. She said, this couple from Canada, she said, well, we want to see you do something. Do some magic tricks for us. You know? Well, I do this because people don't want you to preach the gospel, but they are interested in the object lessons. And so I've used this a lot of times with my relatives. Great opportunity to preach to your relatives. So I went back to my back to my sleeping car and got my little bag of tricks I carried with me, a few rope things and a few other things. And I brought them back there, and it's really amazing. So here we are in this dining car. Now listen. You ain't allowed to preach in China. If you pass out tracts, they will shoot you. I mean, there are only two places that are really dangerous. Russia, it is not dangerous. China, they will shoot you. Cuba, they will put you in jail. Okay, those are Cuba and China are the only two places I'm a little edgy that you got to be careful where you're at and what you're doing. And so the only people they allow in the dining car are who? The politicians and soldiers. Okay, so we're in the dining car, and it's real small. It's only, good night, about half the size of this platform here, you know, about like that. You know, the tables are real close, just a small group. And so I'm going through these object lessons, witnessing to these folks from Canada, going through the gospel using these object lessons. Well, let me tell you, you're in a dining car doing anything, everybody is watching you. And I had a chance to preach to everybody. And the nice thing is, if the government comes up and said, "What are you doing?" Well, I'm just a humble magician. I just do these, you know, these magic tricks. You know, I don't tell them the magic tricks, they're straight Bible truths, okay? But you use that as kind of a camouflage. And so anyway, after we got done preaching there to all these people in the thing, the word got spread to the other cars that there's a magician down there doing a magic show. And so, Dale, every car that when I started to walk through the car said, "Nope, nope, nope, you cannot go through here until you show us and preach to us with your object lesson." And so all seven cars, I stopped and had a chance to preach to everybody in all seven cars. I said, this is a great missionary opportunity. You could just go up and down in the train and just preach to people all the time, you know, using these object lessons. And if the government says anything, "Oh, I'm just a magician. I just do these magic tricks," you know. And it was just a real, real opportunity. So after China then, and after preaching in the leper colonies in Thailand, we had a chance to go on to Africa. And I was over here preaching at the Landmark Baptist College, Dr. Mickey Carter. We had a great revival at Dr. Carter's camp one time. The only time, Dale, in 40 years of preaching, I actually seen an old-fashioned revival. We was there in his camp. We was there speaking in that camp. He has a camp there, Christian camp, where kids come for during the summer. And boy, I'm telling you what, the Lord came down, and we were there till like 12 o'clock at night with people, teenagers, weeping, getting right, apologizing to their parents, and all kinds of just the way you want to see it happen, and it usually doesn't happen that way. Well, that week, it happened the way you want to see it happen. And we had a great, great revival. So I was down there teaching a course on chalk art. And we have a chalk art TV station called on the livestream.com TV network, and it runs 24 hours a day. And I recorded the chalk art TV station. While I was there, one of the men there named Jonathan, I can't remember, Azazu, I can't remember how you say his last name, but Jonathan and Pearl, and he was a great guy. He got his doctorate degree from Landmark Baptist College, and his thesis was "How I Know the King James Bible is the Word of God." That was his doctorate thesis. And he got a teacher certificate for the state of Virginia, and this young man, wonderful guy, was teaching in Virginia, and because he had an earned doctorate degree in education, he was making $70,000 a year teaching English as a second language in the state of Virginia in the public school. Now, for a black boy from Ghana, West Africa, that is pretty good, okay, $70,000. But God dealt with him about going back and reaching his own people. He quit his $70,000 a year job, had a work permit to work in the United States, said, "No, getting people saved is more important." And so he went back to Ghana, West Africa, and we went over there to help him and had a great time. He had a open air. Ghana, West Africa is a wonderful place. The nicest people, some of the nicest people you ever meet is people in North Carolina, wonderful people here in North Carolina. And the folks in the Bahamas, have you ever been down to the Bahamas? The Christians in the Bahamas are just wonderful people, aren't they? Just nice. Lost people in the Bahamas are better than some Christians up in Ohio, in America, amen? And the folks in Ghana, West Africa are like the folks in the Bahamas. Just really, really genuinely nice, wonderful people. Just, you know, just enjoy being around them. I told them, I said, "When you march into New Jerusalem, I want to march with you guys. I ain't marching with a bunch of white people. I want to get them over here. I like the way you sing." You know, they can sing, brother. They make the roof rattle. And so went over there and preached with him and had a great time. And I was really concerned because you need to get a building. And they were renting a vacant lot and put a little galera, just a roof, over there. And they never had to worry about anybody stealing. He left a video projector, his PA system, and it was open. No sides, no walls, okay? I said, "Aren't you worried about it?" "Nah," I said, "it'd be okay." His wife left her purse in the car when we stopped to eat at a restaurant. And I said, "Pearl, you left your car." "Oh," she asked, "nobody about that." And we had a great time there. But when I went to go there to Ghana, West Africa, I went and got all my shots, had to get a yellow fever shot, had to get malaria pills, had to get all this different stuff. And I asked the nurse at the health department in the United States, I said, now, what are the medical problems I need to be aware of and not get sick there in Africa? And they said, well, you got your yellow fever shot, you got your malaria pills, you got these other things, diphtheria, typhoid. Said, now there's three things we don't have any shots for. I said, what is that? Well, we don't have any shots for AIDS. They have a lot of AIDS in Ghana. We don't have any shots for Ebola. That's the blood coming out of your eyes and your ears and their stuff. And we don't have any shots for leprosy. Okay, so be careful you know, where you eat and stuff. Don't get leprosy, don't get AIDS, and don't get Ebola. So I'm thank God I didn't get any of those things. Amen. But we had, I guess we had 300 or 400 saved. We preached in town of the main thing there, the main capital, and then we teach that town of Koro, Twi. The language there is the language of Twi. And so we were able to set up a internet TV station. While we were, this last year, a guy called me, a handicapped guy, and he said, Brother Haig, he said, they now have where you can have your own free internet TV station. He said, we have set us up an internet TV station and have your videotapes on there preaching. Would you like for us to set you up a TV station for you? I said, well, if they're free, I want four. I want one in English, one in Spanish, one in Russian, and one in Chinese. So now we have an internet TV station that runs 24 hours a day. It's on livestream.com. Go www.livestream.com. Type my name in there, Bill Haig, B-I-L-L-H-A-A-G with a space, and it'll pull up some of our stations. Now, originally we started out with 21 TV stations in 19 languages. Now we have almost every month we're adding to that. I just added one for Singapore last week, and we now have 75 internet TV stations. Now, right now, people can watch it live in China. Right now, people can watch it in India. We went to India and had 150 folk Hindus get saved in India and set up several internet TV stations that they can broadcast from India. And right now they can see it all over the United States. They can see it all over Russia live. We're in the Russian language, and all over Latin America in Spanish and in Portuguese. We have 75 TV stations right now in 42 different languages. We got a readout from Google, and Google said, okay, who's watching? Anybody watching? Yes, and they gave us a list of 103 countries that are watching our internet TV stations. And not only 103, how many people are watching? We're averaging almost 1 million viewers a month. We're now up to about 15 million viewers this last year and a half that have watched the Gospel of Luke in 42 different languages. They've watched the Light of the World by Chick Publication. They've watched the Burning Hell in English and Spanish. They've seen the Cross and the Switch played about Nikki Cruz and the teenagers that got saved out there with David Wilkerson in New York City. That is in 8 different languages. And we have the Joni Erickson story about the handicapped girl. And just a lot of different Christian films are in these different languages. And so we're just praising the Lord we're looking for great things to happen. We'll be in Cuba, God willing. We'll be having a crusade, 2 citywide crusades in Cuba during Easter. So appreciate you praying for us. I'd like to get in and get out without getting arrested, without having any problem with the government. They let us in because they want the tourist dollars, but they don't want us preaching. Now, we got a special permit to preach, but I'm just hoping we can get there and do that without any problem. So appreciate you praying for us. This has been 42 years preaching the gospel. We went to the Arctic Circle. I forgot to mention the Arctic Circle while we were in Puerto Rico. We had a chance to go on. The guy called me and said, I want you to come to Alaska. We went up to preach to Alaska, had several people saved in Alaska, went to North Pole, Alaska, had a blizzard come up, went down to 20 degrees, the heat went off in the church, and it was the best attendance we had all week long was during the blizzard. And I'm driving out there, I'm going, if I wasn't preaching, I'd stay home. It was the best attendance we had the whole week. One man, 27 years old, came forward and got saved. And I said, isn't that good? That young man got saved. His father said, I want to thank you for coming. My son is a 27-year-old that got saved. And he just tried to commit suicide 2 weeks ago. And this is a real answer to prayer that he finally got saved. Then we went up to the Arctic Circle, to Fort Yukon. From there, I think it was in Fairbanks. And we went up from Fairbanks with Missionary Star, preached in the Arctic Circle, 20 below zero, and they had an outhouse for their bathroom facilities. I preached an entire week Bible conference on one Saturday. We started about 9 o'clock. I preached at 9. I preached at 10. I preached at 11. We had a lunch break. We had Mexican tacos in Fort Yukon in the Arctic Circle made with moose meat. Tasted just like beef. And then I preached in the afternoon at 1 and 2. I preached 5 sermons that Saturday. And then we flew back to Fairbanks. And the guy told me, he said, well, we had 3 people saved just after you left as a result of the meeting. So we had people saved in the Arctic Circle. We had people saved in Guatemala with the volcanoes going off. We had them preached on the island Montserrat when the volcano blew up and completely destroyed the island. It was a couple years after we left there. And so we went to Russia, Red China. It's just been amazing, and we're looking forward to God doing many, many more things. We'll be going to Cuba this year. We'll be going to Mexico. We're talking to the pastor from Vietnamese. Now, what I do now is every Sunday morning, I go to the Russian church in Pensacola, Florida. I record their services at 8:30 and put them on a Russian TV station. At 9:30, I go to the Vietnamese church, which is only about 5 blocks away, and I videotape the Vietnamese services at Vietnamese Baptist Church, and I put them on our Vietnamese TV station from 9:30 to 10:30. At 10:30, I get in the car, and I drive 5 more blocks to the Korean Baptist Church, and we actually do the last 2 services at the Korean Baptist Church. They have high-speed internet, so we broadcast their services live into Seoul, Korea. And then in the afternoon at 4 o'clock, I go to the Filipino Baptist Church. We went to the Philippines. We preached in the Philippines on the island of Cebu. We have some photographs right there. If you look down there, what number is that? I think it's down there, number 10, number 9 or 10, where it has the terrorist there. My wife and I flew to the Philippines to preach in the Philippines. The Muslim terrorist blew up 2 buses, blew up a mall, a shopping center, and I was very concerned because sometimes I don't have my wife with me. But this time we had my wife with me, and I called the U.S. Embassy, and I said, while we were flying over there, while we were in the air, this Muslim attack in Manila, where they blew up 2 buses and a mall, and I called the U.S. Embassy, and I said, look, I have my wife with me, and I'm supposed to go down here and preach on the island of Cebu. And I want to make sure that there's no problem because I know most of Muslims are down there in the southern part of the Philippines. He said, that's true. Most of Muslims are down in the southern part. But the island of Cebu is a very, very Christian nation. Some of the biggest churches in the Philippines are on the island of Cebu. They have an independent Baptist church that runs over 2,000 people. I preached in that church. We went around and preached in villages. And so we were able to get in and out of the Philippines without anything. So I appreciate you praying for us. We'd like to get back to the Philippines. We'd like to get into Vietnam. The pastor there, the Vietnamese Baptist Church in Pensacola, wants me to go with him to Vietnam and do some chalk drawings and preach over there. We have a Vietnamese TV station. Appreciate you praying for us, praying for this internet ministry. We're now up to 15 million viewers this last year. We have average about 1 million. We have over 3,000 videos on the internet right now, drawing, preaching, gospel magic, chalk art. And I checked it out. I did a search on Bill Haig, and it appears over 3 million times. Those 3,000 videos are being played on over 3 million different websites and things on the internet. And we're putting new ones on there all the time, putting more on there all the time. And this will be our ministry. If the rapture takes place, if I die, I'll still be preaching 3 million different places on the internet. So appreciate you praying for us. Well, we are under-supported. We've got to raise about $300 or $400 a month support. The economic situation in the United States has created a financial crisis. Some missionaries have lost as much as 40% of their mission support. You would think after 40 years you wouldn't have to raise any support, but it's really bad. One guy said this. He said, "Man," he said, "a guy that can paint like that," this is in Puerto Rico. He said, "A guy that can paint like that, can draw and preach like that, and do gospel magic," he said, "I'll bet you never have any financial problems." I said, "Let me tell you something. My car," this is in Puerto Rico, I said, "my car out there has 250,000 miles. The latch is wore out on the door. I have to tie the door closed with a rope through the windows." And I said, "I'm praying that I can get home tonight without a flat tire." I came out after the service that night and had a flat tire. I went out, and then the jack broke. It was one of them good days where Murphy's Law, everything goes wrong. So please pray for us. We need to raise more support. If you want to help our ministry, you can send it to Dr. Bill Haig, 6024 Kingswood Drive, Milton, Florida, 32570. Dr. Bill Haig, Kingswood Drive, 6024 Kingswood Drive, Milton, Florida, zip 32570. Thank you very much. Let's pray. Father, thank thee for your goodness to us. Thank thee for this opportunity to share these 43 years. All these wonderful things have been happening. Some kind of scary things happening, but you've got us through it. Through many dangers, toils, and snares we have already come, was grace that brought us safe thus far, and grace will lead us home. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.